Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. This morning we've received apologies from Rhoda Grant. And before we begin, could ensure all electronic devices are switched to silent. Our first item of business is to consider whether to review the evidence taken as part of our follow-up inquiry into the salmon farming in private today and at future meetings. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item of business today is to commence our follow-up inquiry into salmon farming in Scotland by hearing from two panels of witnesses. This will be the first of a number of evidence sessions that we'll be holding over the coming months and follows an extensive inquiry in session 5 by the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. That committee produced a report in 2018 which included 65 recommendations for improving salmon farming for government, its agencies and the aquaculture industry to take forward. I want to make it clear from the outset that our work does not intend to reopen various debates around salmon farming in Scotland that we've already explored in depth during that committee's inquiry. Our inquiry is quite simply to assess the level of progress made in implementing the recommendations agreed by our predecessors. So with that disclaimer out of the way, I am pleased to welcome our first panel of witnesses representing environmental and animal welfare NGOs. Joining us this morning, we have John Aitchison, Aquaculture Group from the Coastal Communities Network. We have Sean Black, the Senior Scientific Officer for Aquaculture from the Royal Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. We have Sarah Evans, the Aquaculture Policy Officer from the Marine Conservation Society, and Rachel Mulrellan from the Scottish Director from Wildfish. Also welcome Edward Mountain, who's attending today, and I will bring you to the end of the members' questions once they've completed their questions. Edward, can I ask you any declarations of interest?
Thank you very much, convener. And as I did during the REC inquiry in the last session, I would like to make a full declaration of my interest that I am a partner in a salmon fishery on the east coast of Scotland. The salmon fishery employs 3 full-time employees and provides numerous other jobs for people in the area in relation to the tenants that we bring in. It does generate income, all of which can be found on my register of interest. The reason why I don't think there's a conflict of interest in my taking part in any of this today is that there are no fish farms that I believe affect the salmon fisheries on the east coast. All the fish farms are located on the west coast, and the salmon that migrate from the River Spey, which is where I have my interest, migrate up the east coast and then head north. So it can't be affected by it, but there should be no doubt that I have an interest in wild fisheries management, which I've been undertaking for about 45 years. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. This morning we've got about 90 minutes for questions, and I'll kick off. It's been estimated that salmon farming is worth approximately $760 million to the Scottish economy in 2021 and provides over 1,500 full-time jobs. In your view, does salmon farming bring economic and social benefits to Scotland, and how could those economic and social benefits be improved? And we'll start with Rachel.
So thanks for having me today. On the jobs and economic question, we obviously recognise the need for high quality, future-proof jobs on the west coast of the Highlands and Islands. That's beyond dispute. We do not think at Wildfish that salmon farming has a place in this future. If you look at the proportion of jobs that salmon farming represents in the Highlands and Islands, the increase in the last 30 years, so between 1990 to 2020, there was a jobs increase of 465 jobs across the region. If you look at the total jobs growth across the region, over the same time period, you see 22,100 new jobs being created. So actually, as a proportion of new jobs being created in the Highlands and Islands, salmon farming represents only 2% of this. And it comes at a huge cost to the environment. We feel that the Scottish Government has never done a net benefit analysis of the salmon farming industry. That is quantifying, balancing the positive contributions, economic contributions of salmon farming against the negative impacts and the potential impacts on other economic contributions that could be viable in a different environment. In 2020, we commissioned three economic experts to evaluate the economic contribution of open net salmon farming, and they concluded that the Scottish Government needs to address this as a priority and should conduct a cost-benefit analysis.
Thank you. Sarah.
Again, thank you for having me here today. The Marine Conservation Society doesn't take a position on the economic benefits of salmon farming. We are purely from an environmental perspective. What I would say is that one of the recommendations in the REC report was addressing the need for a social licence within salmon farming communities, and that is something that we do support and think needs to happen.
Yeah, because we're looking at something like 66 million positive impact and employment costs, so that's not to be sniffed at in a rural area.
Yes, I would agree with that.
Hey, Sean.
I think very much in the same view. We are an animal welfare charity first and foremost, so we don't have an official position on the impact of to the economy that salmon farming brings.
Okay, John.
So I live in a coastal community on the west coast. I'm from Argyll. There are jobs in salmon farms. They are important jobs. All jobs are important. Jobs don't depend on how the salmon farming is done. So if the salmon farming is done better, the jobs would still be there. If it was done even better, there could be more jobs. The processing jobs, which are a big part of it, can be dependent on just a supply of fish. The fish can be produced well or not well. So there is there's a separate question, which is how do you actually produce the fish? It's worth noting that the number of jobs on the farms themselves, which is about, the government's figures of 1,508 in 2022, that's only 3% more than there were in 2018, the direct employment. And in Argyll, it's actually fallen. So there were 17% fewer jobs now than there were in 2018. The point is that there's automation happening. The farms are consolidating into bigger units. They have fewer people. There's 7 people on average. If you divide the number of active farms by the number of people employed, it's about 7 per farm. Direct employment.
I suppose something I want to ask, that whilst the economic considerations may not be your primary interest, but every type of food production has an impact on potentially biodiversity, climate, or animal welfare. Given the huge economic benefit, the 760 million it brings to the Scottish economy, is there not a place for a well-managed fish industry in Scotland, given that every activity that we undertake has some sort of impact? And is the output not in proportion to potential impacts on the environment and animal welfare? Can you go back to Rachel?
Yes, so again, I wouldn't dispute that there is a place for aquaculture within the Scottish economy. Like, I think that's clear to my mind and at Wildfish, our mind. Salmon farming is not the only type of aquaculture. And actually the sustainability of producing a carnivorous fish, so a fish that takes in more wild-caught fish than it produces, to our mind, that is not a sustainable food system at all. So, yeah, I think actually there is a place for aquaculture, but I think we're looking in the wrong places in terms of what type of aquaculture we are promoting in Scotland.
Okay. Anybody else like to comment? Yep. Sarah.
Yeah, I think it does need to be recognised that salmon is a food production system, all of which do have impacts. What we would say is that whilst I think there can be a place for salmon in Scotland's future, there needs to be changes before it can grow. Particularly, we need to recognise the fact that we are in both a nature and climate crisis at the moment. And that needs to be addressed going forward, or there won't be an industry, particularly in terms of the impacts of climate change at the moment. Unless action is taken, it doesn't really matter, because there won't be an industry to argue over.
Okay, thank you. John.
I completely agree with that. And also, those figures that you're quoting, Kavina, are exclusive of any impact costs. So they're only the benefits. So if you subtract the loss opportunity costs to fishermen and so on, then those figures go down quite a lot.
Okay, thank you. I'll move to a question from Emma Roddick. Excuse me.
Thank you, Convener. So the Griggs Review in 2022 recommended the need for a social contract in the consenting process that recognises the local community and its needs. I've had constituents complaining, you know, they see the impact, but they don't necessarily see a benefit when they're looking at the profits that are made at these farms and feel that there should be more seen by the communities in terms of benefit to them. Do you think that that's improved recently, and what more could be done to ensure that?
John, talk about that. So you mean financial benefits, I think.
I assume mainly financial, but certainly there could be other benefits.
So the Scottish Aquaculture Council, you know, the government's done a vision for sustainable aquaculture, and the Scottish Aquaculture Council, which meets, doesn't include any community voice at all, apart from COSLA, so the councillors are there. The arrangement, as I understand it, is that the councils will receive payment from the industry, and they'll decide where it goes. So separately to that, the companies sometimes give money to individual islands, particularly island communities like Colonsay. I think it's £10,000 or £20,000 a year from profits of many millions per production cycle. So there are some financial benefits, and they've helped on Colonsay a bit with housing. They've put some money into affordable housing, some for their own staff and a bit of money for the community as well, which is genuinely helpful. But in a broader sense, we have to be extremely careful that offering money in exchange for putting up with the status quo, which is actually the situation, because the farming hasn't improved very much, is a kind of bribe. So there's a risk that in advance of communities deciding how they feel about a consenting decision, that they're being offered money to say yes, and then not to have an improved form of aquaculture, but just to be paid to put up with the existing dirty form.
Add to that from our perspective, I mean, just anecdotally at Wildfish, I'm contacted almost weekly by people who live in coastal communities who are concerned about applications that have gone in for new farms or applications that have gone in for expansion to existing farms. From our perspective, actually, the only tangible thing that's come from the Griggs Review, which is this streamlined consenting pilot, is actually really detrimental to communities being able to feed in to the planning process, because it's essentially speeding up the process, and it's giving people in local communities less time to get to grips with what is a really complex subject. Like, we have groups that literally go from having no knowledge of salmon farming to knowing enough to have a degree in salmon farming within months, but this takes a toll on people in the community, and actually to streamlining the process just cuts down the amount of time available from our perspective for people to feed in and voice those concerns.
So in terms of the consenting process, what would you like to see more as standard from growth and expansion in a particular community?
Communities. So I'm here for the Coastal Communities Network Scotland, which is a group of 21 communities around the whole coast, and I live in a coastal community, and there are others nearby. Some have farms, some don't have farms. From the community perspective, I've got some notes here on what people have told me in advance of this meeting and, you know, over the years. What the general gist of it is that you can't make any difference to it as a community. If an industry comes along, big industrial corporation with a lot of money, and wants a farm in a particular place, the only thing that will stop it happening is if it contravenes a rule. So if it's going to affect the national population of a priority marine feature, for instance, it might be turned down, it may not. If the community, like on Gear at the moment, there's a big farm proposed west of Gear, and the majority of people surveyed by the community council said they didn't want it, but the decision hasn't been made yet, but the council isn't obliged to take that into as a material consideration. It can listen to them, but it won't make any difference to the decision. It never does. So communities, I think the biggest thing is, if a community really, really doesn't want it, and it's being foisted on them by an external big company, then actually the community ought to have the final say. It's not national infrastructure, it's not a power station, it's a private company wanting to impose an industrial farm on a place. Some places are unsuitable, and one of the reasons they're unsuitable is the community doesn't want it, for practical reasons, not just because it's ugly, but just for practical reasons, because they use that place. Like, one of these is the Clyde Fishermen's Association. It all feels very undemocratic. I really don't think we can continue in this vein. Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation, we object in principle to the insidious creep of this industry rendering ever-increasing areas of our inshore waters unfishable. that's ignored by the planning system. They hear it, but they don't take any notice.
So I think that's interesting, because the need there has been identified, that there is other fishing going on, and the impact is assumed to be negative on that. Is there a way of balancing that at the consenting process?
No. Well, it's just the farm will make more money. That's the way it's balanced. Yeah, will it make more money? Can they fish somewhere else? Is the assessment. And the fishermen say, no, we can't fish anywhere else because the seabed is not uniform. So the Clyde Fishermen's Association are really saying, this place is where we go in the winter. It might not look very busy in the summertime, but it's a safe place in the winter when it's stormy outside and we can't go to the usual summer places. We have to go to this place. But that's dismissed. It just doesn't count.
Seeing like the way the planning process happens at the moment, you have statutory consultees, which are the regulatory bodies, and various other bodies, but the community doesn't have that statutory position within the consenting process.
Come back in. This is not unique. It's not unique to the salmon farming industry. Your arguments, if you'd search and replaced fish farm with wind turbines or commercial forestry, so this is not specific to aquaculture. It's an issue generally with communities and their ability to influence planning decisions and what may be in the wider, broader community's interest or national interest, because the same argument could apply to commercial forestry, wind turbines, solar farms. So it's, are you indicating that there's an issue generally with community voices when it comes to planning issues?
True, but the specifics of aquaculture, so the Salmon Scotland has an engagement, community engagement charter, and they say it's in our interest to work with communities. The community is part of the inherent natural asset of a place. We will always work to communicate why we're so keen to develop a site. Where relevant, we'll engage communities in a vote to allow the local people to have a direct say in what's happening. Consider putting the decision to a community vote. It's the ultimate test of whether the case has been made for a site and has the support of the wider population. That's the industry saying, if they say no, we should back away, which Maui has done, not I think only Maui, but only for islands. So coral and egg, for instance. So that's outside the planning system.
Again, it's the argument we often hear about what is community? Is the community those who live in the area, those who feel they're stakeholders, opinion holders, and then you've got the interests of the wider community or the wider nation, if you like.
National figures, didn't you? Yeah, so it's in Scotland's interests, but it's only in Scotland's interests if we don't trash something else that's also valuable. So that's the... You know, in the long run, you don't want to damage the renewability, the regeneration, the sustainable use of the sea, or other people's sustainable use of it for a less sustainable use.
Rachel, did you want to come back in?
It was Emma.
Oh, beg your pardon, Sarah.
I just want to circle back quickly to the point on the Griggs Review and what we think can go further. One of the points it raised was the ability for a salmon farm, either where it's no longer a suitable site or where our knowledge has improved and we don't think it's a suitable site anymore, for them to be able to give up their licence in order for that site to either be used for shellfish or seaweed farming or even return to nature. That's something we've not really seen the uptake of, but we really support that recommendation and think it should go ahead.
Okay, Emma.
Is it likely that any farms would be interested in doing such a thing?
One of the points it made was that in order to encourage the industry to do that, there would need to be sort of a presumption of ability to scale up in another area so that they're not losing biomass, or potentially when we have the effective spatial planning in place to go, you have a licence for this much biomass, this isn't the area that you need to be growing it in, and to sort of presume a farm in another location will be given the go-ahead where there are likely to be less environmental impacts.
Okay.
Can I just add, in relation to this point about like new farms, new developments, at no point in these, it's not in any reference anywhere in the recommendations, there's no mention of animal welfare, the welfare of the fish. If we're moving to offshore farms, which might be a reasonable thing to do, we need to consider the welfare of the farmed fish as well. You know, these locations are... You know, there's a lot of tidal movement, the weather can be quite bad. So that needs to be part of the consideration. We shouldn't just be doing it to Well, we shouldn't do without consideration of the animal itself. If we're moving it to these exposed locations, that needs to be considered quite high on the agenda. There's no reference to it in the recommendations, so that needs to be considered as well.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'd be interested to understand if you think there's been sufficient progress in the implementation of the previous inquiries recommendations regarding environmental impacts on salmon farming. And in particular, I'd like to hear your thoughts around climate change and spatial planning. And maybe I'll start with John.
No, there hasn't been sufficient progress. It's 6 years. I took part in the Eclair committee hearings 6 years ago. It's 6 years in November since the REC committee published its recommendations. So the second recommendation, right at the top of the list, was there needs to be urgent and meaningful action on environmental impact, fish health, and regulatory reform before the industry can expand. So since then, I think there's been very little change. The status quo is still pretty much the same, and there have been about 50,000 tonnes of new biomass consented, given planning permission, since the 2018 inquiry published its report, with another about 50,000 in screening and scoping or pending decisions. So that's a lot. That's the opposite of what that recommendation was. The changes that have come in are really quite minor in that time. CEPA sea lice framework is probably the biggest change, and it's just been applied only to new farms this year. In that time, mortality has got very, very much worse in the farms. It's gone from when the inquiry happened, from roughly 4 or 5 million fish dying in the sea, only in the sea stage each year, to about 17.5 million in 2022. That's taking the weights reported to CEPA and converting it into figures of individual fish from the FHI individual fish to weight ratio. 17.5 million dead fish in 1 year is not an improvement in fish welfare. It's not urgent and meaningful action. Whatever actions happened, it hasn't made a difference. So but to answer your point, Ariane, about climate change specifically, when we're all aware that it's got warmer these last couple of years, it's not unique. An indication of what the near future is going to be like all the time. It's 2 degrees above the average in the North Atlantic sea surface temperature for the last year, basically. If the sea doesn't get below 8 centigrade in the winter, the pathogens from the previous year pass on through and then affect the fish. Mortality goes up. The jellyfish are worse. Algal blooms are worse. Everything's bad for the fish. There's less oxygen in the water. That's why mortality is spiking. If we don't recognise that climate change is going to be doing this increasingly, we're not being realistic. And climate change is a given. It's not going away. Salmon are a cold water animal. They don't mind the warm water, but all their pathogens love it. We're consenting farms in places like West Gear, potentially, all these ones in Argyle, where I live. It's too warm in Argyle to humanely farm fish. These mortality levels are inhumane. There's unnecessary suffering happening in these farms. And we're just promoting more and more of it, 50,000 tonnes since 2018. It's completely ridiculous that that's not part of the planning process. And Marine Scotland, the Marine Directive, ought to be advising local authorities on this, but they're not doing it.
Definitely climate change is playing a role within the industry. And there was a peer-reviewed report that came out earlier this year that attributed two reasons to the rising mortality on salmon farms, which is a trend that's happening across the world and has been seen over the last 10 years. The first is the impacts of climate change, but there's also the increased reliance on technology. And I think it's really important to remember that technology will not take us away from the issues associated with climate change, because actually they seem to be contributing to larger mass mortality events happening. What we've seen in the last 6 years is that there is this trend of what's called innovation within the industry, but it's basically problem solving and trying to desperately problem fix. Because, for instance, warmer waters means there's a greater proliferation of sea lice on the fish on the farms. This obviously necessitates more chemical treatment to rid these fish of sea lice because of the negative impacts on the wild migrating salmon. there's a rising resistance to this chemical's use, which means that actually the industry has increasingly been using physical treatments, so running the fish through physical treatments to remove the sea lice. This then weakens the fish. You then have weaker fish, compromised fish, going back into water that is warming. And actually then disease can also proliferate on the farms in warmer waters. So I think what we're seeing is this kind of cycle that is exacerbated by climate change. It's not solely explained by climate change, but that's definitely playing quite a negative role.
Yeah, I think I would agree in quite a lot of those points that a lot more work needs to be done both on climate change and on spatial planning. As we've already heard, climate change is driving mortalities. And there was a recognition within the recommendations and within the draft climate adaption plan that there needs to be a specific aquaculture climate adaption plan, and that's not something that we've seen come to fruition yet. Either from a governmental view or from an industry point of view either. But I think the big point that for us is that spatial planning is not achieving what it needs to achieve. We're in the development of National Marine Plan 2. We would like to see that happen as quickly as possible. And additionally, we need to see the regional plans happen as quickly as possible as well. Particularly the Clyde and the Shetland regional plans have seen delays of years. And that can't be allowed to continue. With spatial planning, we need to have an understanding of cumulative impacts across all farms within an area, but across all industries or all activities that are happening in an area as well, until we understand the cumulative impact on the receiving water body. Spatial planning is not currently effective.
Can I just ask... with the regional marine plans, what's holding them up? What's
They're quite difficult to agree.
Yeah,
it just becomes a very very toxic environment between all the different competing uses of the sea. There's so much competition for the space. So an example would be bottom contacting fishing. It's very hard to make an agreement over that. That's one of the most contentious issues. But spatial loss, you know, the fishermen hate the farms because they're losing ground to them. So there's a lot of competing issues there.
I would add that the Shetland Regional Marine Plan has been sitting in draft form since 2021. It potentially needs updates by this point, but the fact that it never got approval to be past the draft stage is a problem. And we need to understand why that hold-up happened.
I had one thing about regional planning as well. The Scottish Government has written a paper, research paper, 2020, I think, so 4 years ago, an analysis of mortality against temperature and against biomass. And what they found, this is government scientists, 81% of the variation in mortality is determined, can be predicted, by the previous winter's temperature, minimum winter temperature, and the biomass of fish. So if you raise the temperature of the water and you increase the biomass, the mortality goes up. It's 81% of the variation, very predictable thing. If you look at the temperatures around where I live in Argyll and you compare them to Shetland, it's much warmer in the south and west. So the Western Isles and Argyll have warmer water than Shetland and Orkney. If you look at the mortality figures in the government's fish farm production survey, the most recent ones, Argyll had 32% mortality, the Western Isles had 38.8% mortality, Shetland had 18.1% mortality, and the northwest had even less than that. And Orkney was a little bit less, a bit more than Shetland. And let's not forget that these figures are way above what Norway has. So Norway this year, there was outrage in Norway. One of the unions that represents fish vets threatens to strike because the mortality in Norway was 16.7% for the year, and in Scotland, the government will tell us that production cycle mortality of 25% is fine because it's not varying. It's not annual mortality, but it's way worse than Norway. And the fish vet union in Norway said it should be 5%. They're going to strike if the government doesn't have a plan for bringing it down to 5% within 5 years. We're sitting at 80% in some farms, 80% mortality, 2,000 tons of fish dying in a 2,500 ton farm, 80% mortality. That's, you know, a lot of fish.
I do want to come back to fish welfare, but if we can focus on the kind of environmental impact just for a moment. John, you'd mentioned the CEPA framework and that was showing good indications. how long does that need to bed in before we know whether it's enough and what more needs to be done?
Sea lice framework, the new one. So wild salmon are declining for lots of reasons, and the reasons are probably different in different places. So on the East Coast, where there are no farms, like Edward said, the decline there will be a different set of reasons to the West Coast, where there's aquaculture. So one of the things that's affecting the wild fish is sea lice from the farms. It's pretty well established. Not the only reason by any means. If you want to stop that, the only thing that's causing that aspect of the decline now is existing farms. New farms don't exist yet. They can't be making a difference. But SEPA's new rules that have just started to apply only apply to new farms to start with. So they've decided they'll implement this as what they call a no further deterioration condition, which is what the maximum they say they can do. So they're saying for each new farm, they'll assess whether or not there's going to be an impact by modelling, and then they'll set a threshold on the farm depending on where it is. So if it's on its own in a place where there are no other farms or no wild salmon, then or sea trout it should be as well, then they won't set any limits on it. If it's in a place where they've modelled and found that most of the capacity for harm has been used up already or exceeded even, they'll strictly control it or may even say it can't go there. But that's just for new farms. So no further deterioration assumes that you have to stop the existing harm that's happening at the moment from the existing farms. If you're going to do that, SEPA has said they'll freeze the lice levels on the existing farms only in the worst places, 19 farms, I think, out of 210, to cap the amount of harm. But if it's declining at the moment and you cap it at existing levels, the worst farms stay really bad. They can have really high lice levels like they've had previously, and the decline will carry on. It's not no further deterioration. It's not, you know, freezing it at all.
Yeah. And
how long would it take to bed in? I don't know. Years. Many
absolutely.
Years.
Absolutely. Sarah.
So that just quickly on the seat, I think, like, bringing it back to the recommendations made in 2018, fundamentally there have been no changes have been made in terms of sea lice levels on the farms since 2018, because SEPA is still in developing this framework, but the framework will not apply to any existing farms, including, as John said, 19 farms that have already been presented as a risk factor to wild migrating fish. SEPA has also said that they don't expect to be taking any action, enforcement action on the farms for at least 5 years, so that would be 10 years or more than 10 years since the original recommendations.
Well, then, you quoted an astonishing figure of over 80% mortality. Where does that figure come from, and what does that actually relate to?
It comes from Salmon Scotland. So Salmon Scotland collects a monthly mortality figure from each farm, which is the farm's own self-declared mortality, and then they tally them up at the end of the production cycle for each farm. It could be a year and a half, the production cycle, and the cumulative mortality over that period is the farm's total mortality for a production cycle. And for two farms, they're both next to gear, so fits this pattern of warmer waters being better, being less good for the fish. They were both 82% in two production cycles, and one of them had 80% mortality the previous production cycle as well. They're the worst two in Scotland in that set of production cycles.
Okay.
But 40 were above.
That's saying that there's a new farm by the same company application in for the same location for a new farm. So I think also relating back to, I know there was a recommendation not to consent to expansion at existing sites where mortalities were high, but we would argue that should extend to companies operating in the same area where there's high mortality rates. We shouldn't even be considering consenting a new farm in an area that the same operator has had 80% mortalities.
Rural Economy Committee's report that there should be urgent action taken if there's high mortality, and there shouldn't be new farms consented where mortality is very high.
Okay, thank
you.
Hasn't
happened.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Good morning to everybody. Rachel, you mentioned chemicals and the environment, and I don't want to, impose on my colleagues questions about welfare that might be coming up, but I'm interested to hear your thoughts about the progress towards minimal impact on the surrounding environment when it comes to use of medications and chemicals.
Yes, unfortunately, again, I don't think there's been an improvement since 2018, because actually chemicals use in absolute terms per tonne of salmon produced has remained quite consistent since 2018, but in absolute terms, chemicals use has increased on the farms as the biomass has increased. So, for instance, emamectin benzoate has increased by 14%, the use since 2018-2023, 33% increase in azamethafos, and 35% increase in deltamethrin. And these are three known chemicals that are known to be toxic to the surrounding environment. So we actually haven't seen any decrease in terms of impacts on the surrounding environment since 2018. And also worth just saying that it varies by producer. So, for instance, Maui, who's the largest producer, has more than doubled its usage of azamethafos from 2018 to 2023. Scottish Sea Farms, which is the second largest producer, has doubled its use of emamectin benzoate from 2018 to 2023. So it's definitely a concern.
OK. I know there's work that's been done by the Global Salmon Initiative to look at non-medicinal approaches to managing sea lice, and so there's continued research and development. So is that something, obviously that is part of the process of research and development as we move forward. But I suppose what I'm interested in here is about, you're saying there's more chemicals are being used or more types of antibiotics. Is that a concern?
Those are not antibiotics that I mentioned, but it's in terms of the absolute volume of chemicals being used has increased. As I mentioned, per tonne of salmon produced, it's remained fairly consistent since 2018, although obviously the recommendations of 2018 were to improve the environmental performance of the industry, so we haven't seen any improvement since then. And I think the point, as you say, on the move to physical treatments, that goes back to what I was saying earlier about actually physical treatments also have problems associated with them. So actually when you run fish through physical treatments, you have welfare issues and you also weaken the fish. So then you're putting in compromised fish back into the water, and that's contributing to these rising mortalities. So I think it really feeds into this cycle. From our perspective, innovation is, it's not moving anywhere. Like it's just creating more and more problems for the industry.
Okay, thanks. Thanks.
So that, would that be okay? If you wanted to reduce pesticide discharges, that the industry can discharge all its pesticides into the sea, that's what happens, it's allowed to do that. The quantity per farm for a period of time is limited, that's how it's capped. If you have more farms, you have more pesticide discharges. There's nothing mandatory to drive a reduction in pesticide discharges into the sea from fish farms. It's the biggest polluting industry of the sea in Scotland, and the government has not set a target that it should go down. It's entirely voluntary. And actually, because the sea lice have evolved resistance to the chemicals, the chemical use is going up. And there are non-medicinal things as well. But they, as Rachel said, they have problems. So cleaner fish is an example. So wrasse and lump suckers put into the farms to pick lice off the salmon. All of them are killed at the end of the production cycle. So one farm, it's called BDNC. It's in Argyll. It's near where I live. They had 182,000 lump suckers put in. They all died. They had 31,000 wrasse, all died. So that's just in one production cycle, less than a year and a half, basically. They didn't report 100,000 of the deaths. So they reported 86,000. 100,000 went unreported because they didn't know what happened to them. So that's a consequence of not using the medicines, or trying not to, a bit, because the medicines aren't working anyway. You've either got to increase the quantity of medicine to make it stronger, or you've got to use something else, but then it kicks into this other welfare nightmare for these fish.
Emma Roddick again for a question to Sarah.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, Sarah, I just wanted to pick up on specifically the environmental impact. What more could be done right now around enforcement to mitigate pollution and impact on the marine environment without kind of new legislation or powers?
In terms of enforcement, I think it's recognised that SEPA needs to either be able to or have more resources in order to enforce things. A lot of the industry at the moment is relying on self-reporting and monitoring. We would like to see SEPA have the ability to go and do more of that testing themselves. I would also say that in order to evaluate the industry properly in terms of environmental impact, we need to see an increase in data transparency. One of the sort of things that was being pushed towards that was building SEPA's new aquaculture website, which our understanding is it's been delayed. And that was going to allow for farm-level information at a much more timely level than we're currently seeing at the moment. And until we can access and have, or not necessarily ourselves, but until that data is accessible, we can't truly evaluate the impact on the environment that the industry is having at the moment.
Okay.
Particularly around, our concern is around farms in and around marine protected areas and the priority marine features. I think more needs to be done on that.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Alistair Allen. Sorry, Alistair. Can you just make sure you're not muted? I think you should okay. You're okay now.
Thank you, convener. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh,
Alistair, if you don't operate your mic, that's it. Go ahead now.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Right, thank you. In 2019, there were revised arrangements for monitoring, particularly around finfish aquaculture, put in place by CEPA. I realise that you have concerns and you've expressed them today, but are the revised arrangements that have been in place since 2019 any better from an environmental point of view?
Who would like to kick off? John,
say something on that if you like. The point of those changes was to try to encourage farms away from sheltered places where the water flow is poor, where the waste's more likely to accumulate under the farm. And it's the solid wastes, which include MMX and benzoate, that the fish have swallowed. So that's the only part of the pollution that it's dealing with. When CEPA showed, I think, an analysis of, I think it was something like 10 early stage examples of how it had made a difference, it reduced the increase in biomass by about a third. It didn't decrease the biomass in any farm, but it slowed down the rate of increase by about a third, according to our calculations. And then if you want a big farm, you're not going to get permission for a big farm in a sheltered water because the exchange of water is too low. So the nudge was to build bigger farms offshore. And the concurrent with that change was a change away from a cap of 2,500 tons as the maximum size for a farm, which was to do with modelling capacity. So the biggest farms now, if you put two of those next to each other, it's 5,000 tonnes. There are two of those in the country. There are some 4,000-tonne farms. They're a bit further away from the well, they're not actually further from the shore. They're just in faster-flowing places. So has it made a difference? They're supposed to do a little bit more seabed monitoring. It probably hasn't made very much difference, to be honest. It's just put the farms in different places. At present, CEPA's got 72 unassessed seabed survey results that have been submitted by farms out of 210 farms sitting there unassessed mostly from 2023. And some of those farms have been restocked. And CEPA doesn't have the capacity to even do that. So providing them with more information is not really helping. They're just not able to do their jobs properly, I think.
Thank you. Anybody else like to?
Can I ask just briefly on the back of that? You've mentioned some of what you see as the shortcomings in this situation. Are you advocating more? You mentioned resources for CEPA, but are you advocating a change in their powers or simply a change in the way they operate?
It depends. I mean, their approach is extremely slow. Change very, very slowly. They don't have a duty to make improvements. They can freeze things as they are, but they have to be instructed to improve by legislation, by ministers. So, yes, I mean, yeah, that would be the way to do it. If you were a business and you were running an improvement in anything, you would get good data, like Sarah said, which is lacking, really badly lacking on mortality, on pollution, on sea lice counts. Everything is lacking. It's not good quality data. You'd set a thing you were aiming for, a key performance indicator. You'd have a date when you were going to review it, so your data would be used for that. You'd do good surveys, you'd make sure your data was good. And if they hadn't hit it, you'd penalise, but you'd incentivise as well. And none of that is happening. There's no intention to improve things as it stands in government, in the legislation.
Rachel?
Thank you.
So just quite simply, just to round up that section, do you believe, can a yes or no, whether CEPA is operating a robust enforcement system, yes or no? No.
In relation to
sea lice, which is our area of expertise.
Well, no, generally. So to regulation and enforcement, do you believe SEPA is operating a robust enforcement system?
For example, so distilleries were fined millions of pounds for breaking SEPA's rules, and the fish farmers don't get fined at all, as far as I can tell.
Okay. Any other comments? Sarah?
The answer is there's been improvement, but it is not as robust as we need it to be.
Okay. Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Since the REC committee inquiry, and you've all, some of you have alluded to welfare standards, but can you indicate whether welfare standards on fish farms have improved since the inquiry?
No, haven't, because the only KPI that we have is mortality. And mortality has gone up. I mean, it's doubled. It's 17.5 million fish in the sea died. This is the extrapolated figure from the weight that SEPA reports mortality in kilograms. Right? You don't measure welfare in kilograms. It should be an individual fish, shouldn't it? So if you extrapolate from the Fish Health Inspectorate figures to the number based on the weight that they also have, but their reporting is partial. They don't get all the reports of deaths. Extrapolate that to the SEPA figures for weight, which is all the deaths, you get 17.5 million dying at sea in 2022. The year before that, it was, I think, 11. The year before that, it was about 8. The year before that, 8. The year before that, about 5 million. So, no, things aren't improving at all. They're going the opposite way.
I think from our point of view, if we're talking about welfare or mortality,
I'm talking about welfare.
I think on welfare, we'd say it's not. I would disagree with John and say it's not got. Welfare of the fish is still improving. Our knowledge is still developing. We don't know much. We don't know enough about like the positive welfare of fish. What does a life worth living? What is a good life for a fish? There's a lot of this knowledge still developing. I know you'll hear from Lynn Sneddon this afternoon. This knowledge is still developing. But what we can do in the here and now on welfare of the fish, we're not talking about mortality. Mortality is a very crude indicator of welfare, but I think what we're seeing is welfare standards are, we're trying to drive it forward. That's what we do. That's why we develop welfare standards, is to try to push welfare of the fish forward, how people look after the fish, the responsibility people take for their live animals under their care. And I think that's moved forward. I think since the REC recommendations, we've had two new set of welfare standards that have come out for Atlantic salmon. We have over, I think it's over 700 standards, so we're trying to push this forward. Mortality's not improved.
How do you measure welfare?
Welfare is an incredibly difficult thing to measure. We have to use things like fin scores, if you're measuring the individual indicators of fish, but this is why it's very difficult, because to do that you have to sample the fish, you have to remove them from the water, you have to anaesthetise them. To get a representative sample, you'd have to get hundreds of fish every day, and that's just not kind of possible in the current standards. So you come to reporting, record keeping. What are people able to do in terms of what can they adhere to? And I think on that front, we've seen it push forward. The welfare standards that are created by the RSPCA are still regarded as the highest in the world when it comes to fish. They're about the only salmon-specific ones. So we are trying to push that forward, and the industry is trying to do that with us. Now, yeah, mortality, we acknowledge that it's not got better. If anything, it's probably got worse.
Yes.
But the situation, we are now, because of the poor... I think we can all agree that the reporting of data is pretty poor, and how it's presented, because we're still talking about tonnage of fish. These are individual fish and they should be treated as such, so we should know the numbers. But what we've seen is probably the average weight of fish has... The average weight of mortality has probably increased. So that kind of distorts some of the figures, but we have no idea about the actual number of fish that are dying on farms. So I think if we're talking about the welfare of fish, I think it's got a little bit better, but I think mortality, we acknowledge that it's not improved.
I would just like to voice just a concern that I did also stress to the clerk before this meeting. I think it is important to note that RSPCA is financially involved in the salmon farming industry.
That's not true. RSPCA is not.
No, so RSPCA, funded. Sorry, RSPCA assured.
Direct your comments through the chair, please.
Yeah, sorry. So, yeah, I raised this as a concern ahead of this meeting. I'd like to raise it again. I would struggle to think that RSPCA can be an impartial witness around the improvements in mortality, fish welfare, sorry, considering that they have a scheme through the RSPCA assured certification scheme. They are financially incentivised to certify salmon farms for being high welfare. And I think personally that is a conflict of interest that should be of note.
The RSPCA and RSPCA Assured are separate charities. They have different charity numbers. They're operated in completely different ways.
I didn't hear what you said then.
Oh, sorry. RSPCA and RSPCA Assured are completely separate charities. They have different charity numbers. They have different structures. I work for the RSPCA within the Farm Animals Department. My sole aim is to improve the lives of farmed fish. The assurance scheme certifies farms, but they are separate. They are not here today. I do not speak on their behalf. I'm here as the RSPCA. We do not take any money from the salmon industry.
Could we clarify? Could you ask Sean how much does RSPCA Assured take from salmon farmers? And do they ever turn any farms down?
I think probably we'll stick to the committee members asking the questions or it will turn into a debate, and that's not the purpose of the meeting today. Beatrice.
I'll just go back to what I was asking about animal welfare. And going back to the inquiry from 5-6 years ago, which recommendations have not been met, then? Can you specify?
In regards to welfare?
Yes.
Well, there wasn't really much on welfare. It was all about health and mortality. And I think if we're talking health and the health of the fish and the welfare, they're quite separate. But I think mortality, very few have been met in any kind of regard that we would accept as being far enough. There's mention of accreditation schemes in the recommendations, but that's not really something that we've seen being pushed forward enough. I would need to see the exact ones about welfare standards.
If you want them. So the second one, urgent and meaningful action needs to be taken to address fish health. No expansion at sites which report high or significantly increased level of mortalities until they're addressed to the satisfaction of the appropriate regulatory bodies. The committee welcomes the fish health framework, saying that ambitious targets should be agreed to achieve a significant and evidenced reduction in mortality for salmon and trout. There must be high transparency about the causes and what causes disease, when disease is prompting early harvest. Mortality reporting should be mandatory. On gill health, the committee has difficulty understanding how expansion of the industry can reasonably occur if this issue is not satisfactorily resolved. It is one of the primary factors contributing to the increase. One of the primary factors contributing to the increase of gill disease is rising sea temperatures. Sea temperatures may become a discussion point around the location of salmon farms. Sea lice trigger levels should be challenging and comparable to the highest international standards. There should be no voluntary sea lice reporting. It should be mandatory, and so should compliance. Enforcers of breaches must be robust, enforceable, and with appropriate penalties. The Scottish Government should fund Marine Scotland to monitor and enforce sea lice regulations. Data provided should be fit for informing regulatory regime and not the industry's choice of data. The industry should pay a better and comprehensive presentation of data.
Okay, so if we talk about mortality, I would say very few have been pushed forward far enough.
Yeah. So you're saying the salmon industry has not done anything at all?
I'm not saying they've not done anything at all, but I think it's not gone far enough. We're talking about the mortality data is publicly available, but it's probably could do with more detail. We would like to see more kind of what actually caused the mortality. Gill disease is so super vague. It's like saying you have a lung infection. It could be more detailed. I think the transparency around this 10, I think the recommendation was for the farmed fish health framework to develop 10 mortality causes. We could do that being public. The Norwegian Veterinary Institute do a really robust report every year where they look at what's driving mortality, what do the people on site feel are developing issues. That should be the kind of thing that the Scottish Government is looking to have every year, so that it should be transparent. Every farming industry should be transparent about what goes on in the farms, what mortality happens, and salmon more so. Because of the concerns, they should be open and honest about what is coming, because the only way we can tackle working with other stakeholders, the only way that we can push forward in these issues is to know what they are. So I think there's more to do, but I think in comparison to some of the other areas, the mortality's probably moved along slower in terms of the recommendations.
I just find it surprising, because I know fish farmers who care very deeply about the welfare of the fish. So,
and we talk about mortality levels. It's worth noting that there are farms that have mortality for their whole production cycle of less than 10%. So it is possible. It's not like every farm has 25%. So it's trying to tease out what are the things that separate the farms that John mentioned against ones that are 5%, 10%. This is work that we try to do. We understand that there's other stakeholders trying to do it, because for example, within our welfare standards, if we could find that, what that was, it's the kind of thing that we would ask for as we move forward. So.
But the committee said, let's shut the ones that have got very high mortality if it can't be controlled. You know, time after time, it constitutes unnecessary cruelty.
Can I ask a simple question? What are the indicators of fish welfare? Surely mortality and health are the key indicators. What other indicators are there when you decide whether welfare is good, poor or otherwise?
Sure, yeah. Mortality is kind of... Mortality can be like the end indicator of poor welfare, but mortality can occur without poor welfare before. So they're not intrinsically linked all the way through. So some of the things that in our new welfare standards, we're starting to ask for farms to be scored in welfare indicators. So they're individual fish, and it's things like fin scores, scale loss, wounds. So you can score that in individual fish. On a larger group, so if you're talking about on a farm, in a pen, you're looking at what's the behaviour of the fish, what's their feed intake. But it's still quite blunt, and of course one of the problems with fish is that they live in the water, so it's really difficult to get an understanding of what's the natural behaviour of those fish.
But this is not a new industry. This is not an innovative way to farm fish. This is something that's been around for a long time. So surely you should be in a position to see whether, in general, given the indicators you've suggested, whether fish welfare in Scottish fish farms is either on an improving graph or a declining graph. What is your view right now on that?
Well, I think we're still building up that database, but I think it probably depends on... We don't have the historical data on that kind of stuff, because it's not moved forward.
Sorry to press you on this. So you actually have no indication where animal welfare regarding fish farms is improving or declining, because you don't have the data?
I can tell you what I think, but no, we don't have like KPI okay. data from... I mean, our welfare standards have been 20 years, so we've still got a lot to do.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick question. Looking at some information from the University of Victoria, it says that there has been an increase in mortality in Norway, Canada, the UK, Chile, Australia and New Zealand. So what work is being done to learn from... It's not just a Scotland problem, it's a global issue. So, you know, rather, I suppose my... I just want to highlight that it's not just a Scotland problem. So what work is being done to join up all this, like, scientific knowledge?
We certainly need to speak to experts from around the world in regards to what is going on in other countries, what things are they doing to drive forward and tackle some of these issues. We also know that there are larger, there's like tri-nation scientific meetings every other year, I believe, in different countries where they talk about what's the current issue around gill health or heart health. But a lot of this does tend to be quite... We are still learning a lot as stakeholders about what drives a lot of this. So these meetings go on, we have these discussions. Maybe there's a better way for joined-up thinking. I think a lot of, as we're talking about, mortality data still... We don't have a good enough understanding because the reporting is still messy and stuff. So I think there's a lot that can still be learned, but there is conversations going on all the time between different parties.
Okay.
Could I add something to that about what the industry would say? And yes.
Of course. Very conscious of time, and we do have a few members that still want to ask questions. Can I bring in Rachel Hamilton and then... Oh, beg your pardon, the other Rachel, but Rachel Hamilton is also wanting to come in the back of this. Do you want to ask your question?
It actually develops this line of questioning, Convener, so you might be able to get an opportunity, Rachel. As we know, salmon farms have a legal requirement to report weekly sea lice counts, but I'm wondering whether... Sean just said there that the reporting is messy. That's what you said. So can you categorically say whether the reporting of sea lice and mortalities has improved in recent years on that basis?
Yes, because at least it's happening. But Scotland's aquaculture website, where a lot of this data lives, is quite convoluted to use. It's not particularly easy if you wanted to, like, take the data out of it. So at least it's been done, but it needs to be better. Norway have a good system, which is, I think it's called Barrett's Watch, where it's much more It's much more up to date, it's much easier to use, but the kind of Scotland's aquaculture website is it's messy, it's clunky, but at least the data's coming in, which is an improvement from where it was.
Okay.
Yes, just to add to that, yes, since April 2021, salmon farms have had to report weekly sea lice counts to Scottish ministers, and these are published in arrears on the SEPA website. We did a little bit of analysis of these figures before coming today, and almost 20% of submitted counts since 2021 have been no counts. So that's been a data gap. So we have a data gap of almost 20% in terms of sea lice reporting. Also worth reiterating, these counts are self-reported and they're unverified. And that's really significant in terms of SEPA is using this data to base its sea lice framework. And we struggle to see how they can do that with such a big data gap and also without verifying the counts that are coming in from the farms as well.
So in your opinion, do those who operate the farm assurance have any input into the data gathering as such, so that those farms that should be giving information are doing so, and then they're following it up? So if I look at some of the circumstances where there are no counts registered, there's all sorts of things, like I looked at the site and it said weather, withdrawal period prior to harvesting, vet advice, site recently stocked. What input do the assurance scheme providers have in ensuring that salmon farms are giving this advice?
It's an interesting question. I'm not sure, to be honest.
Well, maybe Sean.
Yeah, sure. So at the moment we default to the fact that they should be doing it in line with legislation. There is, I guess, there might be scope to improve that as we go forward. This kind of whole thing about no counts is very, again, it's kind of convoluted because it's accepted by the Fish Health Inspectorate as a legitimate reason, but we can see periods of time where there's maybe like weeks and weeks go by without counts. But like these things are legitimate reasons that you're not able to catch fish, because if it's a withdrawal period, you probably have to cull those fish because you can't put them back into the pen because they can't go to the market with anaesthetic on them. So there could be a better way for, I guess, for farm assurance standards and schemes to press them on it. But like that feels like a government thing ultimately, for the government to be harder on it than farm assurance schemes. We are voluntary. Our schemes and standards are voluntary. That seems like it should be something that the government should be doing.
Mr. Richardson.
If a big farm, if you compare a very small farm with a very big farm, big farm's got a huge number of fish in it, lots of lice, a lot more lice from that farm coming out into the wild to affect wild fish and also fish health than the small farm. So the count has to be scaled to the effort put into the counting has to be scaled to the biomass of the farm, but it isn't. So the number of fish counted for lice is incredibly small compared to the number in the farm in a big one. If a farm has 1 million fish in it and you count the lice on 50, it's meaningless. The data's worthless. You need thousands of fish each time, each week, counted to make a meaningful, accurate, relatively statistically accurate figure for how many lice there are in the farm.
So that's really interesting. What would make that more a practical exercise that was meaningful?
Well, the only way to do it really is to photograph the fish and then count the lice on them. So if you had a lot of people, you could do it. With frames, as they pass by in an underwater camera, you could count the lice. But AI could do it. It's happening in Norway, I think. They're developing AI for counting lice on fish in situ without handling them.
OK, and Emma Harper quoted that some of the welfare and mortalities was similar to Scotland, but the figures I've seen for comparing to Norway are actually, that's not the case. So,
worse in Scotland and Norway, but as Sean was saying, the data that's published by the government is atrocious. So the only data that's comprehensive, because the Fish Health Inspectorate data has lots of exceptions, you don't have to report less than 1% mortality at a given event. You don't have to report in the sea. They don't have to report for the first 6 weeks when the fish are in the water, because so many die when they first put in salt water. Those are not included in the Fish Health Inspectorate's data. So the Fish Health Inspectorate will show you how many individuals they've had reported. but it's a very large number more than that that have actually died. And the only way you can get access to that information is from SEPA, and it's in kilograms. So you can tally up how many kilograms of fish or tons of fish have died, but you don't know how many individuals there were. And they used to collect that data, SEPA, until the cyber attack, and then now for some reason they've decided they don't want it. They're just collecting kilograms in data.
Okay, so they've tried to make their life a little easier because they haven't got the capacity to gather that data.
No, it's reported by the farms. They don't gather it themselves.
Okay, so just to be clear, it's not something that has to be... It's not in statute, it doesn't have to be gathered and reported to the Scottish thing, Government.
Not the individuals, not the individual fish that have died, no.
Okay.
If we reported there's mortality incidents above 1% of the fish dying on a farm, then it has to be reported to Fish Health Inspectorate.
And there's an average over 4 weeks as well, that's 4%. So,
yeah. So if this committee was to ask the RSPA assurance group to come in and give evidence, they would be able to provide us or disclose that information.
We through the standards, we ask that the same data comes back that this government asked for, which is we ask for producers to report mortality above certain thresholds on a week so that we can go in and perform as a percentage, but we don't get a full data set. Nobody has a full data set. I don't know if Salmon Scotland have a full data set.
Okay. And my last question on this particular issue is to Sean Black. Do you have regular meetings with the Scottish Government about the issues of severe welfare and mortality?
As the RSPCA, we have regular meetings with lots of people, including the Scottish Government. But it's to discuss... we don't discuss individual farms or cases or anything. It's more about the general work going on across both organisations so that we are not so much aligned, but so that we are aware of anything that the government might be intended to do, but also that they are aware of what we are doing. But we have those meetings with lots and lots of stakeholders. We don't just exist in our own sphere. We want to push forward certain things. So we don't discuss individual cases, but if there was some big welfare issue that existed in the industry, we discuss gill health and plankton jellyfish with them, but we don't discuss individual cases. I guess RSPCA Assured might if there was a welfare abuse case, but I don't know that for absolute certain. It's probably actually an animal and plant health agency. That probably falls into their remit.
They're responsible for welfare, for enforcing the Animal Health and Welfare Act. It's worth just pointing out that nobody sets an upper limit on mortality. There isn't a figure for what's the maximum acceptable mortality. The government will say, work towards the lowest possible. And in Drumion Bay, where it was 82%, that was the lowest possible. So apparently that's acceptable to the government and to RSPCA Assured. There's no KPI for maximum mortality. It's got to come down. That's what, we all agree that. But they didn't have any sanctions for having 82% mortality.
I'm very conscious we're halfway through the questions and nearly completely out of time, so I'm going to have to ask the panel to try and keep their answers specifically to the questions that are asked. My next question comes from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. Can you hear me?
Yes.
It's a question for the RSPCA. Can I ask how you and possibly other agencies that you know of were involved in revising welfare standards for farmed Atlantic salmon, how were those standards developed, and did you find your involvement in them adequate?
So I can tell you how we develop ours and develop revisions. I can't speak for other groups like ASC. So we take in, so we try to revise on a biannual basis, so every 2 years. In the intervening period, we take in feedback from different stakeholders, including our assessors, RSPC Assurance assessors, about the issues to progress. We then speak to wide groups of stakeholders to work out what does the develop in this area look like? How do we push forward on welfare outcome assessments? What's the best indicators to develop? We then take that to what we call our standards technical advisory group, so that we get feedback on how can it be implemented on farm. We then take that feedback away, we write the standards, and then they go off to a accreditation board, which is more of an RSPC assured thing, but that group is CSI, which is supply chain and site. I can provide the exact thing. So we develop them all in-house, we write the standards, that's how we do it we aim to do it on a biannual basis.
And I should know this, but just for people watching so they understand this, because I'm sure you're asked this regularly, the SSPCA operates in Scotland, the RSPCA is often advertised as operating in England and Wales.
Sure.
Can you just explain how this point becomes relevant when we're talking about salmon?
Yeah, sure. So the welfare standards that we write as the RSPCA can be used, in theory, for farm animals anywhere in the world. They're not Scotland-specific, they're not UK-specific, they're not England Wales-specific. So we just operate in that kind of realm. As we develop the welfare standards, that's part of our role, and they can be used anywhere. It's where we come into the play within Scotland is that RSPCA Assured, the assurance scheme, is UK-wide. It doesn't operate outside the UK, so it just operates within the whole UK. We work closely with the SSPCA. I have regular meetings with them to, again, chat about issues and what's going on. But it's because of the RSPCA Assured that then, because we're working with Scottish farmers, that's where our tie comes into that. So.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Peter Swishart.
Thanks, Convener. And just on that point, I'm just looking at a news article which says that the RSPCA, the animal charity, received £700,000 in fees in 2022 from salmon farmers and producers for its RSPCA assured labelling scheme. So it's just you...
I've already answered that, so that's a lie, and that's misconstrued by whoever has written that article. RSPCA Assured will have received that money, but none of it comes to the RSPCA.
Okay. My question is actually how your standards go above and beyond legal standards in Scotland. I mean, when you look at organisations like QMS and some of the supermarkets, they go above and beyond in having the quality of product. So I just wonder how your organisation does that.
Sure. Well, there's no species-specific legislation for welfare in Scotland for fish at any point. Fish aren't even covered by the Welfare at Time of Killing Acts in the UK or Scotland. So there is almost nothing. So the fact that we even exist as a standard is above and beyond. So we have things about like maximum time fish can be out of water. Obviously, we have lots of standards about sun and slaughter, how to handle fish. None of these are covered by legislation. So everything that exists within the standard is above legislation.
Well, do you think then your standards are required by regulation then?
I don't quite understand.
Well, the standards that you use for your assured scheme, do you think that there should be some kind of regulation around that?
I think there should be. I think there absolutely 100% should be regulation in Scotland for farm fish welfare, and then the scheme and the standards can exist for those who want to go above and beyond, like they do for QMS or the other organisation meant in other farm animals, in beef, cattle, but sheep, chickens, whatever, there is regulation for those farmed animals, and then if people want to go above and beyond, they can sign up to RSPCA Assured. It should be the exact same for fish. It shouldn't be left to a voluntary set of standards and scheme to be the welfare regulation. It should absolutely 100% be. There should be legislation.
And in terms of the scheme operating, I understand that announced visits are made to fish farms. Is that correct?
Announced and unannounced.
And unannounced. Yeah.
Unannounced tends to be in response to either a complaint, a concern, or if the farm is under special measures. If we've had a previous concern that we haven't been able to sign off. RSPCA Assured haven't been able to sign off. That farm might be subject to unannounced visits in the future. Unannounced is tricky for a fish farm because you have to get a boat out from a farm. So it's not like you just turn up and you're there, but it's as unannounced as it can be.
But it's only if you've had any kind of complaint. You don't just, go and visit a fish farm that there's no complaint about.
RSPCA Assured would not do that as a matter of course, I believe.
OK.
OK, thank you. I'm now going to move to Eleanor Whittam, who's going to ask the next two questions.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I'm really interested in the interaction and potential risks between farm salmon and wild salmon populations. The REC committee recommended that a precautionary approach should be taken to minimise this risk. The panel's already spoken a little bit this morning about the risk from sea lice. I'm also thinking about the introgression of the genetic issue as well. Would like to ask first, John, and perhaps, do you actually think a precautionary approach has been applied?
In a very minimal way. So there is a precaution, there's one major precaution, no salmon farms. There's a presumption against salmon farms on the north and east coasts of Scotland to protect migratory fish. That's government policy. It has been for a long time. Hence, there's recognition there's a risk from aquaculture. In terms of the SEPA regulations, the precaution is this no deterioration, so-called no deterioration condition that they've imposed on sea lice numbers in water bodies, specific water bodies. In our opinion, CCN's opinion, it isn't going to result in no deterioration. It's locking in previous high numbers of lice on farms that had high numbers of lice. It's not limiting those in existing farms. So decline, if it's caused by sea lice, is going to continue. The precaution doesn't apply to smaller fish. The rule is, if a post-smolt salmon, 75 grams, passing through an enclosed body of water, gets more than two lice on it, SEPA will say that's not acceptable because it can harm that fish and the population of those fish. So they've got a density of lice in the sea that these fish might encounter over 24 hours. If that's exceeded, then SEPA will say there's a problem in that water body, but they won't do anything about it for 4 or 5 years, as Rachel was saying, even if they have modelling evidence that it's likely to be the case, unless presented with really hard evidence. But the precautionary principle doesn't work like that. The precautionary principle is supposed to be the other way around. If there's a known risk, but you don't know how bad it is, you apply a precaution. So there should be caps on all farms on the number of lice on them. Like in Norway, 0.2 lice per fish during the spring on every single farm, with mandatory slaughter if they exceed that during the spring when the wild fish are passing by. We should have done that here.
I have another question with regards to escaped farm salmon and the interaction with the wild salmon population. I mean, it is a very multifaceted situation, and my dogs just came back in, sorry, from the dog walker, walking on the back of the couch here. But if anybody wants to maybe comment on that, please.
Can I bring in Rachel? She was going to, address some of the points from your first question.
But I can talk about escapes as well, certainly. Briefly. Just wanted to reiterate what John was saying about the SEPA sea lice framework being really far from precautionary, because it's basically the premise is that SEPA feels it needs to collect evidence of harm being caused by specific farms before it will take any action against those farms, such as biomass reductions, and it's estimating that it will take 5 years to collect that evidence, according to SEPA. So that's, you know, the opposite of precautionary. We're also seeing this at a local planning level. So just in the last 6 months, there have been two new farms given planning consent, one in Shetland, one in Kilbrannan, both given planning consent in the last 6 months in areas where there are known to be migratory fish routes. So I think we're also not seeing that precautionary principle being enacted at the local level. On escapes, there hasn't been any significant progress since 2018. The Wild Salmon Strategy, published by the Scottish Government, outlines plans to consider introducing penalties for escapes, but nothing more concrete has come than that. There were more than 52,000 salmon reported to have escaped in 2022, and a 2021 Scottish Government study has found evidence of genetic introgression at 23.2% of its surveyed sites. So it's definitely an issue, and it's not been addressed since 2018.
Thank you. And Convener, my final question is round about the fact that the committee is aware that Wild Fish and Coastal Communities Network have submitted a complaint to the Environmental Standards Scotland regarding SEPA sea lice regulatory framework, which you've already touched on. Is there anything else you would like to add around about why you've submitted that complaint and what your key concerns are? We've heard some of them. Is there anything else you'd like to add, either Rachel or John? Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, fundamentally, yeah, as you mentioned, we've submitted that complaint to Environmental Standards Scotland. We do not feel that the proposals by SEPA comply with the relevant regulations. We do not feel they're taking a precautionary approach to sea lice and the impact on wild fish populations. I actually would like to say we will submit that as evidence after this session, because actually it would probably be helpful to share the full complaint with members of the committee.
It's also true that I think SEPA is correct in saying that it can't act to improve things without being instructed to do so by ministers. And so all it can do is freeze things as they are. That's what they say. They failed to freeze things as they are, I think, by allowing existing farms to have the lice levels they previously had in high-risk areas.
I'd just like to come in on Eleanor's questions. No? Okay. Ariane, the part of your question, I think, regarding escapes was answered. Do you still have a supplementary?
Do. Thanks very much. Yes. So, yes, some of it was touched on. But, Rachel, you mentioned just now in your response that the Scottish Government was looking at bringing in proportionate penalties. And I'd like to get a sense from you and others if you think that penalties, if indeed they were to be introduced, would be for fish farm escapes would be sufficient, or do you think there should also be penalties for breaches of licence conditions like the use of controlled chemicals or for significant mortality events or breaches of sea lice levels?
I mean, yes, in our opinion, there should be penalties for breaches of all of those conditions on farms. They should be set out, as I think John said earlier, there should be, you know, limits set on farms, and those should be enforced. So actually, just quickly in relation to the sea lice counts, we've actually had a look again at how many sea lice counts have been submitted since 2021 above the 2 sea lice or 6 sea lice per fish limit. There have been 1,391 counts submitted above 2 since 2021, which is 2 sea lice per fish. There have been no prosecutions as a result of this. So I think that really does indicate that, yeah, there needs to be proper enforcement taking place on these things.
And what do you think would be a proportionate penalty, and where do you think the revenue from those penalties should go?
The thing is with the fines that they're capped, they'll never be very large fines. So a financial penalty isn't a very effective method. A penalty that reduced the biomass that the farm could farm next time would be a really substantial penalty, because if it ramped up, if there's a second breach and a third breach and it went up again, in that the biomass went down, then the financial hit is extremely strong and the farms become unviable below a certain size. So that would be a way of doing it. I think you might find, if you ask SEPA, that informally they do actually do that. They make farms have less biomass when they've fouled the seabed and can't do anything about it. But they then allow them to creep back up again and then keep testing. And because they changed the rules in 2019, some farms that were non-compliant before just became compliant with no actual change to the pollution.
Can I just clarify? So when you're saying the reduction in biomass, so that's a reduction in the numbers of fish. And if that keeps getting reduced, at some point, it becomes economically impossible for the farm to operate.
Yeah, and you could do that with mortality. You could do it with sea lice counts. You could do it with pollution. You could do it with pesticide discharges. It would be the only effective method, really.
At the beginning of this conversation, you were talking about the kind of introduction questions were around economic and social impact, but you pointed out that we bring in a great amount from economically, but you talked about the environmental impacts, then that's not measured in balance to that. So that's what you're talking about there.
It's called externalising cost, isn't it? The costs on the environment are not included in the costs to the fish farm. The polluter isn't paying. You know, it's one of the environmental guiding principles. Tackle the source of pollution at source and make the polluter pay, and they're not paying. It's externalised on other people and on the sea.
Thanks. Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Regulation on the use of acoustic deterrent devices has been tightened. Can you comment on whether this has addressed welfare concerns in relation to cetaceans and also the stress factors on salmon of predators around the cage?
Only briefly. MCS was very supportive of the tightened regulations around ADDs. It's not something that we specifically have a viewpoint on, although as part of our membership of Scottish Environment, like, I could certainly talk to other members that have the expertise to answer that question properly after this session.
If I could add something then, CCM was instrumental in that happening. in that we were pointing out to the government that it was not licensing the ADDs when they were disturbing cetaceans. So it coincided with the American Marine Mammal Protection Act coming into force for countries that export seafood to America. And they wouldn't allow ADDs, any of the existing ones. So the ADD ban was on that type of ADD, and there are now acoustic startle devices being developed, which NatureScot's trialling in Shetland rather quietly. Not that the devices are quiet, but they're doing the trial rather quietly. There's a high risk that they also frighten cetaceans, so it needs to be properly tested before these things are deployed. If you take a lot of fish and put them in a place where there are seals, you can expect the seals to be very interested in the fish, and they'll come up, and they do look at the fish through the pen nets and bite them. They sometimes even get inside. One of the things the industry is doing is just getting bigger pens, so the centre is further from the edge, so the fish are in the middle, and the seals can't really stress them so much. But it is, I think, true that stressed fish get diseases more often if they're having constant seal attention. It makes them sicker.
Anyone else?
In relation to farm fish, I think it's a lot of, since we've had the ban on ADDs and everything else with seals, there's a lot of talk about what is the impact on the fish, but again, I don't think it's quantified because nobody has the data, and it's probably a worthwhile piece of, you know, worthwhile exercise to find out, well, what is that impact? Some of it we can maybe quantify if mortality reporting was a little bit better. Some of it's kind of an unknown about, like, the stress of the fish leading to other diseases, but that work would probably be quite worthwhile because it doesn't seem to exist. Anyway, nobody seems to have that exact number out there, but what is the actual impact on the farm fish? Because that gets forgotten a lot when we're talking about seals. These are fish that are being predated on.
Okay, thank you. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Just briefly to Rachel, fish escapes obviously vary wildly year on year. What should be getting done to prevent it? And can you just give an indication of what the demonstrable impact of escaped fish is?
Sure. So escaped fish compete. There are two impacts of escaped fish on wild salmon populations. There's either the competition for resources, or there is the hybridization, so the breeding with the wild fish, and then the genetic compromising the genetic integrity. I did mention just briefly before that there was a 2021 Scottish Government survey, which found genetic introgression at 23.2% of the sites surveyed, so maybe around a quarter of rivers surveyed had indication of genetic introgression. In terms of, I wouldn't know how you could prevent escapes. Because obviously open net salmon farming by its very nature, it is an open net structure. And, also increasingly farms are being located away from shallow coastal waters for good reason, but going into exposed waters where actually there's then more severe weather that they're subjected to. So you saw that in 2020 with the Carradell farm escapes, 50,000 escaped salmon from a farm in Carradale because of bad weather. And I think also it's worth saying that the industry is increasingly looking to go offshore because of the environmental impacts of the industry in the coastal waters. And we will see an increased risk of fish escapes in offshore locations because, again, they'll be subjected to more turbulent weather implications.
Sarah.
Just quickly like to add on the offshore, that is one of the potential solutions to overcoming climate change. We think innovation in this area is potentially a good thing, but it does need to be assessed properly. The upcoming technical standard review of infrastructure and equipment for salmon sites, that is a great opportunity to ensure that we're looking further ahead. So not what equipment needs to do now in terms of bad weather, but if we're looking to move to more active sites, with rougher weather, we need to be looking ahead at what the standards need to be then, but we need to start looking at that now.
Is that okay? There was a recent presentation by a scientist from the Scottish Association for Marine Science who said in high exposure sites, mortality increases more steeply as the temperature extremes, so as the temperature goes up, compared to less exposed sites. And there was an increase in lice infestation at high temperatures with strong coincidence of lice and amoebic gill disease. And what he's thinking is that wave exposure is greater in exposed sites and it stresses the fish, doesn't kill them, but it makes them more likely then to be affected by disease. And if the water temperature also is higher, which is, of course, happening, and you get stronger storms with global warming, then it'll make it worse. Mortality goes up.
Thank you. And last but not least, Edward Mington.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I don't. One of the questions I think could be best dealt with by a letter. I'm slightly concerned that I don't understand the difference between the RSPCA and the RSPCA Assurance Scheme. The Articles of Association say that the RSPCA can appoint the chair of the Assurance Scheme and members of the trustees, and they share the uses. So I think it might be helpful for that to be clarified, because I'm confused by that. I don't want to argue about it. There are 65 recommendations in the REC report, of which I stand by 64. One of them I don't stand by. And I want to look at recommendation 3, which is the committee notes a call for a moratorium on new salmon farm development and expansion of existing sites. It considers there is insufficient to support this, i.e. a moratorium. Do you think the committee was wrong or right? A yes, no answer will do. Can I ask each member of the panel?
I think there was sufficient evidence now, and I think there was sufficient evidence then, and there is sufficient evidence now.
Okay. Sarah?
I think moratorium is too strong, but before there is significant expansion, more work needs to be done.
Thank you. Sean?
I will agree with that I think moratorium too strong, but I think rather than running headlong into expansion, there's a lot of issues still to sort.
And John?
So, if I'm correct in thinking, moratorium means temporary pause rather than a permanent stop, then it should have happened. There was evidence then and there is now.
Okay. And, Convener, just the final question. I think that what concerns me, and I was corrected by the industry, antibiotic uses had gone up between 2017 and 2021 by 168%. It dropped back in 2022. But deaths continue to rise. I think 36,000 tons of deaths in 2022. I haven't collated all the 23 figures yet. But there seems to be some antibiotic resistant and lice treatment resistance. Have you heard of this, and does it cause you concern? Particularly, I guess, to Sean and to Rachel.
I guess, yes, we've heard of it, and yes, it causes it of a concern. So is every antibiotic resistant bacteria in any type of farming, but as it relates to salmon, yes, to both.
And yeah, the rising use of chemicals that I outlined earlier in the session is of concern, both for the environmental impacts, but also the fact that the industry is looking to other solutions such as cleaner fish, which I know we haven't really touched on today, but you know, these are wild caught fish that are taken from the wild and taken into salmon farms cold at the end of production. So I think the industry's ecological footprint grows as its chemical resistance also grows.
Thank you, Convener. I could go on all morning, but I'll spare you. I'll spare you and the committee that. Thank you for indulging me.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I certainly can agree with you on that point. Thank you very much, Rachel, Sarah, Sean and John, for your evidence this morning. That's been most helpful. Thank you for joining us. I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting until 10 to 11 for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Welcome back. We will now hear from our second panel today, made up of aquaculture scientists. And a welcome to the meeting, Professor Simon McKenzie, who's the head of the Institute of Aquaculture from Stirling University. Professor Sam Martin, who's the Director of Research from the School of Biological Sciences, University of Aberdeen. We've got Dr. Helena Rinaldi, a lecturer and teaching fellow from the Scottish Association for Marine Science. And joining us remotely, we have Dr. Annette Balag, a research fellow in aquatic epidemiology, School of Veterinary Medicine from Scotland's rural colleges, and Professor Lynn Sneddon, who's the chair in zoo psychology, Department of Biology and Environmental Sciences from the University of Gothenburg. And I'm glad I got my lips round all those. So we've got approximately 90 minutes of questions, and I'll kick off with a fairly straightforward one, I think. So the Scottish Scientific Advisory Council, their report on the use of science and evidence in aquaculture concluded that science on aquaculture is not sufficiently visible. So my question is, do you consider public understanding of the salmon farming industry to be based on reliable information? And I'll go to Sam first.
Hey, thanks very much. Do we think that the public view of the salmon industry is based on sort of scientific evidence? Is that what you're asking?
Yes.
Probably not. It's one of the things we try and do whenever we do our research is try and obviously disseminate our results as best we can. Very often that's through scientific literature and at conferences. We all work closely with the salmon industry on their problems. But how much of that actually gets the good stories get out to the public is quite limited. Certainly within the UK, we all realise that salmon farming has got a negative connotation with the media, and it's quite difficult to try and rectify that through with the public. Although there is a lot of improvement, so we're doing a lot of research. Whether or not that gets actually sufficiently to the general public is hard to know.
Helena?
Yeah, I'd agree. I think it's quite challenging to communicate the current status of the industry and the research around it. I think we do our best through various outlets, but I'd agree with your comments, Sam.
So I'm going to move to everyone else. So I suppose what I really want to find out is whether... So we've got a public perception and the aquaculture can... Views on that can be quite polarised, as so many topics these days. But is the public understanding based on accurate information and reliable information? Because the job of this committee and the piece of work we're doing is to see whether there's been progress in the last 5 years. And naturally, it's really important that we base our decisions on accurate information. So, Simon, can I ask you, do you think the information that the public have is reliable and sufficient for them to make up their minds on aquaculture?
Okay. I'm going to concur with my colleagues in terms of what the overall understanding is. I think there's the contextualisation of that information is important. So I think in specific regional areas where salmon farming is a part of the fabric of that community, and there's a much stronger understanding of how that's happening. I think there's two different themes in this space. I think one of those themes is where's it planned, where's the consenting process? That's one side, what people don't understand, and then there's the other side, which is health and welfare. And both those streams of information are different, I would suggest. Okay. So when you're doing that type of dissemination into the public sphere and public perception, you have very different groups, obviously, across your society to talk to. So I would suggest that on an educational level, there is a lack of understanding of farming and on that level, and salmon is a part of that process, if we consider that to be food security and how our society understands what food security is. And then on the other hand of that, I would say, yes, different voices seem to have different impacts, and I think that's probably how you're delivering the information. So yeah, I think it's not a. Sorry, my voice is not very good today because I've been travelling. It's not an open playing field, I would suggest.
Thank you, Annette.
Yeah, I would agree with opinions. And what I often find is that the information of the public might be a little bit outdated already, because the improvements both in industry and new science might not always get to the public timely. So that that could be something that's that it's sometimes lacking.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Lynn. Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, I had a problem with unmuting there. I hope you can hear me okay. Thank you very much for asking me here. I apologise for not being there in person. I think the public are actually pretty clued up on the welfare of animals, and what they're seeing is images and filming of sea cages, of the way that the animals are slaughtered. And I think they're seeing that there are substantial problems that are associated with the salmon welfare industry. And I think the aquaculture industry needs to tackle these problems, because the numbers don't lie. If you have 17 million fish dying in a year, that's not good as a business or for public consumption of that animal. And so I would say that the public are seeing these quite shocking videos, and you can't dispute that the state of the fish is pretty poor in these videos. It could be that it was a bad day when the person went and filmed, but the evidence is growing, and scientists are commenting that there are significant welfare issues within the aquaculture industry. And of course, there are scientists that are trying to tackle this, but these problems are not new. And I don't see that anything has really improved over the last 6 years. So I would say that the public are aware of these problems. And that's why over the last 12 months or so, aquaculture businesses are using words like welfare and saying that they actually care about the fish, which is a good thing.
I suppose one of the statements you made there, I think, sort of illustrated the issue that we have. So you quoted X number of million fish in mortality, but didn't put that into context. So you didn't contextualise it, or actually, there's no information about whether that's proportionate or acceptable. And that's one of the messages we continue here. So we're not actually sure whether 1.5 million fish dying is reasonable, can be accepted and whatever. And I think that's one of the issues we have in the committee, is trying to actually understand whether, it's in context. So, for example, 1% mortality in a beef herd would be, or over that might be significant, but, a 5% mortality in the aquaculture industry may not be significant compared to other types of farming. So it's situations like that, I suppose, the questions around whether the public are getting enough information to make educated decisions on whether aquaculture is making progress.
Sorry, is that addressed to me?
Pardon, yeah.
Apologies. Well, we heard this morning that the industry itself accepts a 25% mortality rate, and that farms report up to anything to 80%, whereas in the terrestrial farming industry, beef, cows, sheep, it's 5% is the aim, and maximum of 10%. So why are we allowing these huge numbers of fish to suffer and die? I personally think no percent is acceptable. That's what we should be aiming for, to keep all of the animals as healthy as possible. Of course, I'm realistic and pragmatic. Of course, the animals get disease. There is going to be some level of mortality. But for me, there is no ethical reason why we can't apply the same legislation and acceptable levels to fish that we apply to mammals and birds that we farm.
Thank you. That's a good place to start. So I'm now going to move to a question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. And I'm introducing a theme around environmental impact. The committee's heard about continuing concern regarding the environmental impact of salmon farming, and I'd be interested to discuss this in the kind of current scientific understanding and whether it supports those concerns, and particularly also interested to hear about, so at the time of the REC committee's work, they welcomed the fact that the UK Technical Advisory Group was going to recommend a new environmental standard level for the toxic sea lice insecticide emamectin benzoate, or as it's often called, SLICE. And 6 years later, that new standard still has not been applied to existing farms, which have carried on discharging the chemicals at the level that they were doing so before the new standard. So I'd be interested to hear about the if we've got scientific evidence on the damage that that will be causing, and also scientific evidence on other damage from other medicines used in salmon farming, and whether this should be assessed in relation to their environmental impact. If I could start with Lynn.
Thank you very much. So these chemicals that are being used to treat the salmon have quite a negative effect on their welfare. Of course, we balance that with the positive aspects of treating diseases and making sure the animals are disease-free. But of course, there's lots of evidence that some of these salmon farms are positioned very near ancient marl beds, and that these chemicals are having a very negative impact on the marl beds and the animals that live within these marl beds. And so what we're doing is we're contaminating an environment that's really important nursery grounds for fishes, for wild animals, and for the animals that they eat. And so this is having a significant impact on the environment around the sea cage. It's not just the fish in the sea cage that are being affected. And I've seen quite a lot of reports where it's showing complete death of these marl beds within the proximity of sea cages. Now, these are important for our biodiversity, for conserving wild species and ensuring that we have sustainable stocks of fish to catch in the sea, because these are important nursery ground for commercially caught fishes. And so there is a lot of evidence, but we have other experts on the panel that can probably better answer this than I can.
Would anybody like to kick in? Sam?
I will a little bit about sort of drug use, chemotherapeutics. I'm not going to answer specifically about sea lice treatments. That's not my area of expertise. But if we think about other drugs which are given to fish, like antibiotics, they're used for controlling bacterial infections, and there has been an increase in these. But we must remember that actually for bacterial pathogens, most of them are controlled very well with vaccination, which has really helped us keep the antibiotic use down compared to what it was in the 1980s and 1990s before good vaccines were generated. A little bit about the sea lice. I suppose we need to remember that the sea lice are not just controlled by drugs. It's an integrated pest management procedure that you use. There's lots of other approaches which are used in combination to keep lice at lower levels. And there is a push, we know, to try and reduce the amount of chemotherapeutics in lice management. It's an ongoing issue. Fish don't die from lice. We have to keep the lice numbers down because we don't want to have gravid female lice on at particular levels on the fish. But it's a management of keeping the lice numbers down whenever fish might have other issues which can compromise them. That's not really to do. We might come on to that later on. So the drug use is only one part of the lice management.
Anybody else like to come in on that?
The sea lice issue is a real challenge for the industry, but what we're seeing is quite an expansion of work to find alternative solutions and find a range of solutions. So chemical therapeutics is one in quite a wide range of management tools now. And we're seeing quite significant research in comparing the benefits of it. So the fate of the chemical therapeutants, if it is in feed or in a bath, often ends up in the benthic footprint below the cage. But that's quite heavily regulated, so they are quite the companies are under severe pressure to keep that residue levels below the regulatory levels. And we are seeing increased research in developing, particularly through the developments of the new sea lice regulatory framework, where we're looking for better tools to support the industry in better understanding how to control the sea lice and how to minimise the impacts on wild fish. One of the tools that is being actively developed is through understanding the dispersal characteristics of the sea lice and better understanding the biology of the sea lice to break the life cycle through management methods and to better understand the kind of black box of the life stage of the sea lice, which is the dispersal stages of the early larval stages in the water column. So we are seeing an increase in tools available to tackle the sea lice in order to reduce the use of chemical therapeutants for them. So that is an increased area of research at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Simon.
Okay, thank you. I think this is quite a complex area which intertwines many different streams of work which are in aquaculture. So I agree 100%, and I think most stakeholders do, that in terms of environmental protection of specific marine protected areas is of fundamental importance, and there is a body of evidence scientifically justified suggesting that we need to consider how we're going to do that in specific locations and how that's going to work, and that ties you into your planning and consenting space, yeah, which is a different type of conversation. I think if you look at the use of chemotherapeutants, now I don't have the data for Scotland, but if we look at the use of chemotherapeutants in Norway, for example, there's about a 60% reduction over the last 2 years in terms of using chemotherapeutants, and that's for various reasons. Let me change that wording, sorry. Let's say medicines. Okay, so if you look at medicine usage in that space, there's about a 60% reduction over the last three to four years. And this is what was being alluded to before, and this has been replaced by what you call non-medicinal treatment. Okay, so it's husbandry or operational routine, which is aimed to try to reduce that load of sea lice burden and disease burden upon the fish. So there is a divergence and a movement towards less in terms of also resistance against those chemotherapeutants and how that's being developed. I'm not in that area, so I can't really talk about it. Of the last 6 years what's happened in that space, which is the direct question you're asking. I do not know the answer to that question.
Thanks very much. I've got a bit of a supplementary on that. So, Sam, I like how you mentioned or you described the physical treatments as, I think, integrated pest management. I'd only heard that in the space of my garden. But what I understand is that those treatments, the kind of washing of sea lice and that kind of thing, bring on welfare issues and actually weaken the fish. So I wondered about that. And kind of, are we tracking that kind of well-being of the fish when we move to that practice? And then also, how do we know? I mean, I've seen images of sea lice being eaten alive, and you said that sea lice don't kill fish. But how can we track that or measure that? Because it looks pretty abhorrent, horrific, certainly an experience, and I could imagine it certainly would weaken the fish. And do we have any scientific process where we're actually measuring that and tracking that?
I think this comes back to the public perception that there are a number of video footages which are always played on YouTube and on the news and one show or whatever, and those are not representative in my mind of what's going on in aquaculture on a day-to-day basis. There are always extreme cases through whatever reasons within a company. Sometimes things will go wrong, and there's no question about that. Those video footages you'd have seen are terrible, but they are not representative of what's going on generally. Quite often, you won't see very many lice on a fish at all.
How do you know this?
Well, I do extensive research on sea cages on the west coast of Scotland, Shetland, Orkney, and up and down the whole west coast. And
What does that entail, extensive research?
Well, we're sampling fish, not for sea lice. We're mostly doing gill health work. So we are doing routine sampling at various times of the year, repeat sampling in the same cages. And from my personal experience, I haven't actually experienced any of the scenes like what you would see on TV, which are, I'm not saying it doesn't ever happen, but it's not the norm by any means.
Okay. Anybody else got any experience with that? And also the weakening of the fish through the physical treatments?
I would say that the companies are obliged to publish their sea lice counts regularly, and there is a commitment to improve the timeliness of release of that data and the counting of the sea lice. But that is seen as a direction forward to improve the sea lice counting. So when you look at the public data on levels of sea lice, I would agree that these extreme cases, they're not representative of the vast population of farmed fish, and the numbers are quite low. I would point to the fact that welfare is really an intrinsic value for the company. It affects their bottom line, so there's a huge interest in maintaining good welfare in order to sell the fish that they're farming. So it's in their interest to develop a wide range of practices. I think some of the alternative treatments you mentioned, the hydrolyzer treatment, so either they can treat with fresh water or also warm water. Every sea lice treatment has drawbacks but also benefits, and my understanding of these sea lice treatments, and I'm not an expert in this area, but it can have quite a narrow window of efficacy where if they get the treatment slightly wrong, then there is welfare issues. But if they get it right, they can be quite efficient at removing the sea lice. But the range of treatment options that they have, the other trend we're seeing is with cleaner fish introduction to cages, where they actually introduce another species into the cage, which then feeds off the sea lice. We're seeing an increase in number of options available, and a combination of all of these different practices and solutions to try and reduce it. But it's in their interest to as I said, as my colleague said, to reduce the levels so that you don't see the gravid females, the pregnant females, so you don't have the full life cycle within the farm. Okay. That's the aim of it.
I think Commissioner Lynn indicated she wants to come in.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment on the other methods and the welfare of the fish. So the other methods are either swimming the fish backwards through jets of water so you knock the sea lice off. But you must remember that the fish pain receptors are sensitive to less than 0.1 gram. And so swimming them backwards through jets of water are likely to be painful. And then the other option is the thermolyzer, which uses high temperatures. So you're effectively putting the fish into temperatures that scald the skin and burn off the sea lice, or the sea lice don't like it, they drop off. And those temperatures that are used are above the threshold for pain in salmon. So we're looking at temperatures above 29 degrees. And I wrote to the Scottish Parliament, the Animal Welfare Committee and to the RSPCA assured to point this out in 2019 to say that this treatment actually causes pain to the animal. And having spoken to people in the industry, these animals don't feed for several weeks afterwards. So they are, in effect, weakened or in a poor welfare state. And we just shouldn't be allowing that kind of treatment to be applied to the animals, and because it causes pain to these animals, and it significantly impairs their behaviour, their welfare, and they're not feeding for quite a long time. So these other treatments have significant problems associated with them.
Yes, Sam.
Yeah, thanks, Lynn. I'm not going to comment on the pain, that's your expertise, but I was going to come back to you about the weakening of the fish due to the lice treatments. I suppose another way of looking at this is if the fish are already weak in any way, compromised by any other problem physiologically, then they can't deal so well with the other treatments, particularly these physical treatments, which require actually moving fish about, moving them into a well boat, which were fresh water treatment or warm water treatment. If a fish are in any way physiologically compromised by bad gills or underlying other conditions, then they can't deal with these treatments as well. So I wouldn't think that the actual lice treatments themselves are causing terrible damage, or, you know, not terrible damage, but, you know, compromising much. I think if they've got underlying other conditions, but then these treatments may sort of exacerbate what's going on. if that makes sense to you.
It makes sense, but just having heard what Lynn said about the pain threshold of fish, it's kind of like becomes even more concerning. And
so there was a project funded by the Scottish Aquaculture Innovation Centre looking at welfare indicators post treatment on what we call a thermolyser, which Lynn has described. So I was only a part of that, looking at gill health following treatment through a thermolyser, and we had all the different controls. We didn't see any obvious differences in the gills after that treatment. We didn't have anything to do with pain, etc. But from the welfare indicators that were used, we weren't seeing anything very negative happening. But it doesn't mean that it's perfect at all.
Okay.
You know.
Timing.
Okay, thank you. So this is an excellent question, because in the last 5 years, this is a certain change at the level of the industry and what's happening, and this is related to what we talked about before in terms of chemical treatment or medicinal treatment versus non-medicinal treatment, and how the process of the farming is impacting upon the animals. Now, I think the evidence is very clear, and I think Lynn put that forward quite clearly, that in terms of pain thresholds in salmon, there's no doubt that over 29 degrees, that is definitely beyond the pain threshold of the animal. The way current information is a little bit fragmented, but in Norway, they're basically also saying that if there's enough evidence, we'll stop that form of treatment and thermolyser. Thermolyser, so everybody knows, is at the moment it's the most used technique. Okay, although there are multiple different mechanical techniques, optolyser, hydrolyser, etc., which are being used to drive that in the industry, and they're using combinations. So the story is about combinatorial. Now, I think what you've seen in the last 5 years, or what's definitely been brought to the fore, is you have mortality rates and you have changes in operation routines, and as they try to bring them together to understand the more optimal way of doing it, there's obviously some issues in trying to understand that. So I think there's a series of different things here. One of them is a very specific methodology called thermolyser, which is the temperature shocking space, let's call it like that, which, yeah, there's definitely a series of ethical issues around that one. And then there's other mechanical treatments or combinations of them. Now, I think if you really look at what's happening at the moment, mortalities in that space and how mortalities, and this is what Sam's talking to, if you look at burden of disease in the animals, the key story is when can you do it and when can you not do it? And if you can't measure that properly, so the body of evidence in science right now is very difficult to measure when can you do that to the animals versus when can you not. Okay, and that is what is causing the threshold problem. There's a real issue there, and I think across the scientific community, I'm sure colleagues can talk to that. Most of our research, certainly in my team, we are definitely aiming towards that space and trying to understand how that operates within the animals. It's called allostatic loading, and I'm sure Lynn's more very used to that. And that's about risk management and benefits. So the thing about it is, if you can't understand where the fish is at, because you don't have the tools to understand its health and welfare status, then that's really complicated. And I don't think the understanding that any of these technologies, obviously you're pumping, you're crowding the fish, you're stressing the fish, this is not a positive welfare situation. It's more to do with how do the fish recover and how long do they have to recover after that process, I would suggest.
Okay. Would any other members of the panel like to add any further comments? No? I've got a supplementary on this from Rachel Hamilton, Emma Harper, and then Emma Roddick.
Yeah, so it's to Professor Sam Martin. If an animal is destined for the food chain and it experiences stress, it is not a pleasurable experience to consume the meat from that specific animal. In this industry, if a fish has experienced poor health, at what point are they discarded? So you're saying that you haven't really noticed that there has been significant severe welfare issues from sea lice. But obviously we know there's a threshold. What happens if, for example, they've been through all these things, they don't eat, if they've had other methods? Do they go into the food chain?
First to answer that or not, but what goes in the food chain and what doesn't go in the food chain. If fish were compromised by certain diseases, they wouldn't be going into the food chain. Or if they were to die, you know, on the farm, they wouldn't go into the food chain. What has been happening here and in other countries as well, is if fish look like they are compromised in some way, they might be harvested earlier. So the farms actually anticipating by looking at, you know, signatures of health, they might say, well, these fish are going towards a health status or a welfare status we don't want them to go to, and they might harvest them early. So that has happened in the past. Of course, the farmers don't want to do that, but sometimes they're required to. It's better than letting a fish get into a worse state. Do they go into the human food chain? Yeah, it all depends on what is wrong with them. And, you know, people don't want to be eating animals which have come from a bad welfare situation. Obviously, it's not ethical. Whatever I said, you know, the bigger problem with the fish welfare, as I say, has probably got to do with sort of compromised gill health. So gills and fish are where they get their oxygen, they breathe. Now, there's lots of parasites in the water, and we might come onto this as well, like micro jellyfish, etc., plankton, which can damage the gills. If the gills get damaged, then the fish are under more physiological stress. It's like us, if we try and run on earth, we've got asthma, we can't do it. So if the fish have in any way compromised gills, then you can't do these physical treatments, treatment for the lice. And then there's this balance of how you're going to treat your animals, because you've got compromised gills, or you might have a low-lying chronic virus, like, which also can compromise their physiological capacity to undergo physical treatments. So it's a combination of things coming together which can cause the sort of the welfare issues. And how you can't maybe treat for one particular problem if they've got another problem. So maybe that's a way of putting it. So I mean, if the lice themselves, you know, when I say they don't kill the fish, they will eventually allow secondary infections to occur. But that is not generally what happens. It's only when things go very, very badly wrong.
Okay.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you. Just to thinking about what Ariane Burgess said about the stress on the salmon, and I'm assuming that using biological methods and using cleaner fish might be less stressful for the salmon. And in the last panel, they said that the cleaner fish were all wild-caught, so that would be the wrasse. But my understanding is that the lumpfish are farmed, and there is work being done investing in millions to look at other specialised cleaner fish breeding and husbandry programmes. So how does that link with improved welfare and reduced stress for the salmon? Professor McKenzie?
Sure. Happy to talk to that. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. So, previously, wild-caught fish have been used, and that has caused some issues in terms of ecological impact of using wild animals. So there's been a significant push in the industry space to be able to produce those animals within a closed cycle, so aquaculture of the cleaner fish per se. Okay? I think that is moving forward at a fairly significant pace, and being able to close cycle on some of those animals would be very positive in terms of us removing that ecological impact on wild animals. I think there's no doubt about that. I think at the moment, the evidence that sits out for cleaner fish and their efficacy, if we're talking about the efficacy of treatment, I think the scientific evidence is a little bit contradictory right now as we stand. So what percentage of individuals are actually actively feeding upon sea lice and how they're responding within that? And also, how do you look after the welfare of cleaner fish within salmon operation routines? Okay? Because it's not designed for that. It's designed for salmon. It's not so much designed for the cleaner fish. So the impact on those fish is important. I think coming back to the question, which I think, if I'm understanding rightly, the original question is, does that decrease the stress for the salmon? That's an interesting question in terms of interspecies interactions and how they're doing that from a behavioural point of view. That may well have a change. It depends on, I guess, the health status of those fish and how they're behaving within that context. It's a little bit more... I think Lynn's probably more specialist than I am in that space, but okay. It's debatable, I would suggest.
All right, thanks.
Lynn, would you like to come in?
Thank you. I just wrote a review on lumpfish welfare, and it really is an area that we need far more research. And no other production system will we think it's acceptable to go and catch a vertebrate sentient animal to grow another vertebrate sentient animal. So it's a very strange approach going out to the wild, catching all these fish, or even farming lumpfish to be able to produce another species of fish. And there is a big gap in our knowledge as to the welfare of the lumpfish and cleaner wrasse. In particular, something like a third of them die within the first few weeks. Only maybe a third or so actually feed on the sea lice. And how effective it is seems to vary from farm to farm. So there is conflicting evidence that it actually in some farms it's not effective at all, and some farms it actually works quite well. But I think these are animals, they're animals that we could eat, yet there is a massive loss of this, if you think of them as units of protein, and we're not doing very much to ensure the welfare of those animals. And really, they're a fish, they're the same as salmon. Why are we using one fish to produce another fish? When we're still using other treatments like chemical treatments and the physical treatments to get rid of the salmon lice problem.
Okay, thank you. Emma Roddick.
Thanks, Convener. The committee last session didn't feel there was enough evidence to pursue certain other recommendation routes, and some of the recommendations made are to address the data and analysis gaps, particularly around discharge of medicines and chemicals into the natural environment. Do you feel that those gaps have been addressed? And have they been addressed to the extent that we can be confident about what the environmental impacts are of these farms? Don't mind who is best placed to speak on that.
Anyone at all?
So my personal opinion is no, probably not. And I think the access to the information and availability of the information is still fragmented. But this, I think the information's out there. The problem is the coordination and the funding of the actual work to be done in that space and bringing the agencies together to make that happen. This has been a decades-long story of where do you get the data from, how do you get the data, and how do you process and make that data happen. And my personal feeling, and I don't know how colleagues feel about this, but in the scientific community in Scotland, the access to the data and the ease of being able to get that and analyse it hasn't been particularly clear and hasn't been very well funded. So I think there's a structural issue there rather than the actual data analysis per se. The data might well be there, but to have a final valid objective approach, I think it's different. So I think it's the way we manage our data.
So the data may be held centrally by bodies, but external organisations aren't able to
absolutely
anything from it.
Absolutely, and don't get me wrong here. I'm not talking only about the aquaculture industry here. You could talk about data as a general thing, okay? And within food production systems, it's a challenge, and it's a challenge to get that data. And I don't think we've been doing a good enough job with that. Agreed.
So, do we know what the environmental impact is of salmon farms?
As a global objective, I think that's a difficult conclusion to come to where we are right now.
Okay, thank you. Yvette, would you like to come in?
Annette.
I beg your pardon, Annette.
Oh, sorry. About data. I wanted to say that it's quite challenging to do this work correctly because, as you can understand, there is so much going on the different farms that it's... You really need quite large amounts of data, different types of data. And then especially if we're looking into preventive measures, like we've talked about the cleaner fish for sea lice, it's very hard to measure something that will not happen because you're preventing it. So, there is a huge challenge there, and it is important to make sure there is enough access to data and there is enough... Yeah, I think it's a very important way of evaluating what's going on, but also very challenging. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Emma Harper wanted to come in to look at some comparisons.
Yeah, thank you. I'll do that right now. So in our papers, it talks about the comparisons with the regulation in Norway and Scotland. And in Norway, it seems, they've been established a long time. It seems that they've got quite a
not a condensed system, but quite a straightforward system. But in Scotland, it's been noted that it's a wee bit disjointed. I'm just wondering what your thoughts are and what could be done different in Scotland with regulation. And I'm looking at Professor Simon McKenzie, because you're nodding.
Yeah, OK. I mean, I think this is an ongoing theme. And we've been talking to this theme for several years. If we start at the Griggs report and we look at consenting, I think that the outcome of that report was very clear, that the situation in Scotland is very fragmented. And it represents an obstacle for us as a Scottish society to achieve what we're trying to do, which is, do we understand really the global impact of it? Do we know how it works? Consenting and planning, are there sites that we really shouldn't use anymore? Are there sites where we shouldn't be going to anymore? Can we consent to make that happen in a different way? So I think that is a significant barrier in terms of going forward, and I think that there's a lot to be done in that space, 100%.
And like, in terms of regulatory bodies, I'm sure Marine Directorate, SEPA,
absolutely.
Government, it's
absolutely.
Is that what makes it a wee bit disjointed?
I think that was recognised by the SSAC, no? When we did that work with the Griggs, so the Scottish Science Advisory Council piece that was done around consenting, and I think that gives some very good sort of ways to go forward in that process and how we should do that and bring together all of the stakeholders in the right space. However, I think we should also consider what happens in Norway and have a look at some of their regulatory approaches, because, for example, if you take their traffic light system and the way they look at sea lice, okay, so that's a green, amber, red scenario in terms of how can you grow or produce on different sites. It's based on basically sea lice count, which is set, and then that is a percentage of the animals. Can you grow on there or can you not grow on there? I think there's some caveats in some of that way that could be done. And maybe Scotland could take a better look at that and come up with better guidelines in that area. And certainly the capability to put regulatory process on top of that. I think there's a lot to be done there, yeah.
So we don't need more regulation, we just need to make it work better and kind of condense the structure?
Yeah, well, I think my point of view is very similar to what we're talking about with data, to be quite honest. I think there's a lot of work to be done with coordination to get everybody in the right space so we know what we're doing. It's like Annette's saying the same thing with data. There's a difficulty, there's a challenge in accessing this data and getting people around the table to make that work. Yes, 100%.
OK, thanks.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to move on to fish welfare, and Professor Martin, just kind of pick up on some of your earlier comments around that. Do you? All right, sorry. I thought we were on to three.
Yes, aye, still on regulation and enforcement.
Right, okay, I've moved on.
So we're looking at environmental impact. If you don't have a question, I've got one,
no,
and then
we can
take your next
I've
one.
I've covered mine for that theme.
Great, thanks. Just so it's to conclude this section, I want to put into perspective. So as a former farmer, I remember we used to inject our calves with selenium to give them a little boost of immunity. We used to give them an IBR injection or they would get BVD. And the back of that, there was quite a high use of antibiotics. So treating conditions as a result of various infections and whatever. But over time, the livestock industry has reduced antibiotic use quite significantly, whether that's as a prophylactic treatment for dry cows and so on for mastitis. So we've seen a dramatic drop in antibiotic use in other types of farming or food production. Are we seeing the same progress when it comes to aquaculture? So this report we're doing, the inquiry, is all about progress and whether progress has been made. So if you compare what's happened in agriculture and the advancement in inoculations and vaccinations or whatever, which the knock-on effect has been a reduction in antibiotics, are we seeing that the right direction of travel when it comes to aquaculture? And is that, are we on the right path to reducing the use of, you know, it's not ivermectin, that's what you use in cattle for warmers, the mecting one. Are we looking at progress that will see the reduction in these types of chemicals? Sam?
Yes, so we're talking about antibiotics. Antibiotics work against bacterial pathogens. Every salmon which goes to sea in Scotland is vaccinated against at least 4 or 5 different bacterial pathogens and a number of viral pathogens. So that's about 60 million animals vaccinated every year. The major pathogens would be like furunculosis and vibriosis, which almost wiped out the salmon aquaculture industry in the 80s and 90s. Vaccines were made against them. if there's a small increase or an increase in antibiotic use in the last couple of years, it's really got to do with sort of complex, unspecified bacterial infections, maybe linked to poor gill health or linked to other emerging pathogens which are coming along. I mean, new pathogens come, and then the researchers have to take time to develop new vaccines. So, for example, we work with some of the multinational vaccine companies trying to understand how vaccines provide protection. There's no, as I understand, prophylactic use of antibiotics like what you would get in the livestock sector. Mm-hmm. That's not used at all. So antibiotic use at the moment would be sort of almost emergency use when it needs to be used. The thing about salmon farming and aquaculture in general is that it's very, very much, you know, you want to keep your health of your fish good. If a vet comes and looks at a herd of sheep or cows, you can go and treat that one sick animal. If you have a cage of 100,000 fish in it and you see two or three sick fish in it, have a virus or a bacteria, you're probably realising I've got a big, big problem. So the idea is to make sure you keep the pathogens out, you know, and keep, you know, especially for viruses and bacteria, vaccination and biosecurity, etc., to try and control it that way. Because once your fish gets sick with an infective agent like that, it's difficult to control.
Mm-hmm. So I suppose, again, my question is down to, is aquaculture industry making fast enough progress? So is it comparable? So we talk about all the medicines that are used in aquaculture, and that's one of the big issues that we've got. Is it comparable to the medicines we use in other food production? Because, you know, once again, we look at the chicken production, antibiotics are really important when it comes to the poultry industry. Are we seeing the same progress being made to reduce the amount of medicines by better animal husbandry or whatever, or animal, you know, are we making enough progress? Is it on the same pace as agriculture and other sectors?
I don't know what the pace in the other sectors is. I'm not an expert in that area, so I can't comment between chickens and fish. You know, so I don't know.
So I suppose the question is your perception, is the industry making enough progress quick enough to address these concerns?
It's sort of almost an arms race against the changing environment, the changing fish, the changing pathogens that we have, trying to keep pace with the new challenges which are coming along.
Sam? Simon, beg your pardon.
Two S's. there's a fundamental difference here in terms of you're looking at fish and you're looking at mammals or birds. So their actual biology in terms of immune systems is very different. So whether you look at vaccination in a fish compared to a mammal or a bird, in a mammal, the gold standard is lifelong protection and memory. Huh? That's a standard for all of us. That's how biomedicine functions. If you look in terms of fish, it is unclear where you have lifelong protection. You have protection which is induced by vaccination, but it's not the same story. So you can't apply the same logic as you would do in a mammal. So cows and pigs and et cetera, because the underlying science and the organisation of the system is very different. I think if you look at development, and I'm not an expert in terrestrial, but if we look at development of solutions, chickens isn't a good comparison either, because the production cycle of a chicken is a lot shorter than it is in the salmon. So, and you have different environments you're having to deal with. So freshwater and seawater in the case of the salmon. And then the chicken, you're looking at a stable environment. So I think overall, I think there has been a huge amount of progress if you took it into the last 30 years and what's actually happened in aquaculture, and this is not just salmon worldwide, and how technology has been developed. There's been a massive development, a huge one, and as Sam's suggesting, you have every fish is vaccinated going into the sea. That's almost unheard of previously. And I think particularly if you want to talk to antibiotics. Now, antibiotics is a word that's on everybody's lips right now because we're all talking about antimicrobial resistance. This is your key story sitting in the background. So the requirement to reduce to an absolute minimum. So if you look at sort of there's some new emerging technologies which have also already been commercialized for Yersiniosis, for example, which is bacteriophage. So viruses which kill bacteria very specifically and do not generate any form of resistance in the bacteria. That's already happened in the salmon aquaculture industry, and that's a first. That's a first in terms of the numbers of animals. So I think on one side, yes, there's a lot of drive to create, let's say, sustainable solutions in the health space, no doubt. I think so. And I think there's a lot of innovation there. I think potentially we just don't put enough
We don't focus on that enough.
Okay, that leads me nicely into the last question. Can you tell me what you believe the main challenges are for the industry regarding environmental impact? What are the main challenges? Helena?
I'm happy to come in here. I think we've been studying the environmental impacts for decades now, so we do understand the main areas of impact. So, you know, the fallout from a cage within a sea loch system, for instance, both particulate and dissolved wastes and the benthic footprints thereof, that's been a major area of development and research. The infections and the parasites and how they might be dispersed in the marine environment, and the concern there about possibility of interacting with other salmonid populations in the wild. That's another area of very active research. Then the welfare issues around the animal production itself, the susceptibility to diseases and how the conditions that they're kept in and maintained in, how that optimises their growth and production. I think these are the main areas of environmental concern, and I think this has been the focus for the research and the focus for the regulations as well. And we have seen real developments in the monitoring of a lot of these conditions. The monitoring of the footprint on the benthos, the chemicals that are in the sediments around where the deposited waste ends up. We are seeing a lot of activity there, and we don't really have anybody from the regulatory side here or from the veterinary side that is monitoring it. So we do have very good processes in place, I would say, in my opinion, to look at this. There are some areas where we need to develop the tools to better measure it, because a lot of it is really challenging to measure and challenging to quantify in a very complex marine system. If we're comparing it to, you know, a terrestrial field or a shed, arguably it is a somewhat simpler environment compared to a very complex hydrodynamic environment of a coastal sea loch, for instance. So it's hard to measure some of these things. And for that, we need to do research. And I think we are kind of uniquely placed in Scotland, where a lot of the research is quite collaborative, and there's few of us, and we try to work together quite a lot, but we're also hampered often by, you know, lack of funding or lack of opportunities to actually do the research and develop the tools. So I think going back to the original question, I think we are aware and have been aware of the major environmental impacts from aquaculture. We're getting a grip of how to measure it and how to regulate against it, but there's huge areas that need further investment to understand it better and develop it more.
Okay, I'm going to move on to a question from Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. Really interesting discussion. It's good to hear from the scientific community. So how has the scientific understanding of fish welfare needs developed in recent years? And do you think the current welfare standards reflect this evidence? I mean, I think we've touched on some of that already, but I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. I don't know who wants to go first.
Who's keen to go first? Simon.
I'm happy to go to that. Okay, so the advances in fish welfare have been significant over the last 20 years, at least, I would suggest. I think it depends, that there's two different things here, isn't it? It depends on who you're talking about in terms of certification. So if it's RSPCA or if it's ASC, or who are the certification body in the great scheme of things, okay? I think earlier points have been made very clear in terms of sentience in vertebrate animals, and how do we have to deal with that, and how should that be managed clearly within the salmon production industry, I think, and also including the cleaner fish in that space. I think we have a good idea of some of those, and that is relating to, let's say, some more ethical problems or ethical issues that we want to discuss. And then on the other side, you've got the biological context of what does welfare mean, and how does that dissociate from health and welfare, and what does that mean for the animals within a culture system. Now, I think there's been significant progress if we think about 10 years past and where we are now and how we're trying to move that forward. So I think the body of evidence and the science per se is actually in a very good moment in terms of welfare as we move forward. I think it's advanced a lot, and it has a lot to give into the space. And I think it's a fundamental pillar of how we need to approach the aquaculture universe, if I want to call it like that. Okay? I think that's fundamentally important. And I think, actually, going back to the last part, we were talking a little bit about environmental impact. There's two streams in salmon aquaculture at the moment. Yeah, there's on land, so removing the animals really from the natural environment versus having the animals in the environment. And there's a series of in-betweens there as well in terms of how you produce the animals. So I think the welfare context is central. And although we don't have all of the tools in that space, I think there's been a lot of advancement in that area.
Progress.
Annette, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you. I wanted to add on that I think we're starting to get in a very exciting time, because before, when we were looking at fish welfare, we were really dependent on taking the fish out of their environment, whereas now we are getting a lot of tools like underwater cameras with new AI developments of recognizing things and seeing things that makes it a lot easier to have a better idea of what's happening underwater without having to actually touch the fish. So we're getting, there is a lot of development in that area that I think in the future, in the nearby future, will give us a lot more information to monitor fish welfare. And I think we'll develop that further, and there will be a lot of advantages to do more with welfare in the nearby future based on that.
Okay, thanks. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I'd like to pick up Professor Martin around fish welfare, because earlier you'd kind of drawn a distinction between pain and welfare, and I want to explore that a bit more in terms of, if a fish is in pain, can it be described as having high welfare?
I would imagine not. I'm not an expert in pain. I mean, I think that's definitely a question for Lynn Snedden to talk about pain. But in my perception, if a fish was in pain, we do not want to have animals in pain. But there's also a balance between, you know, when is it acceptable and when it's not acceptable. But I don't think I'm in a position to comment on pain thresholds, etc. I don't. Okay. Do that.
Lynn, yeah, would you like to comment?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, just to answer the question, if an animal's in pain, then yes, it's definitely in poor welfare. And certainly there's been quite a lot of work on salmonid species to show that they are capable of experiencing pain, that pain is an important event for them, and that has a very detrimental effect on their behaviour, physiology and neurobiology. Just to talk a little bit about the previous question, we do have operational welfare indicators and laboratory welfare indicators, and Chris Noble and colleagues produced a set of indicators and decision process making that I'm sure everybody's aware of in 2018. But whether that those welfare indicators are actually being implemented is up for debate. And I think one of the key aspects of improving welfare is that we do have a set of very clear indicators or thresholds where we can judge the welfare of fishes against that, and more specifically salmon, of course. But we don't have the legislation in place, so we're kind of relying on certification schemes. Most certification schemes really talk about environmental impacts and sustainability. Only recently are the Aquaculture Stewardship Council now consulting on implementing animal welfare standards. So I'm hoping that the future is bright and that there will be a series of indicators and key parameters that a farm must meet to ensure the welfare of the animals.
And Professor, do you think that there's an easy route to getting agreement on what welfare looks like for fish amongst the community? Is there that understanding of what, you know, a happy fish acts and looks like, in order to then provide key recommendations and criteria that have to be met within a farm?
Yes, certainly. I think there is a lot of research out there that shows quite clearly how the animal's welfare is affected by different experiences during the production cycle, and there's lots of research on stocking densities, water quality parameters, sort of species interactions, and of course we've got experts here on the health side. I think it will require very careful management to get the right people in a room to really come up with very clear, easily implementable welfare standards that are transparent and open. But then there needs to be buy. And one of the things I think you ask RSPC Assured and other certification schemes, have you ever thrown any farms off of your scheme? And they generally don't answer. There needs to be buy. If farms aren't meeting those welfare standards, there needs to be action. And that typically is done through legislation, but could be incentivized through certification schemes. It will require quite a lot of management of different stakeholders and ensuring that what we come up with is achievable and is practical and is acceptable to both the industry and to the public and to the government.
Okay, thank you. And looking at the recommendations from last session's committee, most of the welfare-focused ones do look at mortality, which is understandable because that's easy to kind of collect data on. But what other indications to achieve that overview of fish welfare that the committee also asked for is needed? What would the key indicators be beyond mortality that you'd want to see fish farms look at?
Yeah, certainly we could look at behavioural indicators. So are the fishes feeding normally? Do they have a reasonable rate of food intake? Is there no signs of aggression between animals? Do the animals swim normally? Are they using the cage space in a normal way? Can we see that the animals are not sustaining any damage? We don't have lesions. We don't have missing gill covers or damage to the eyes or to the fins. There's lots of morphological indicators that we can do. We can subsample the fish and look at key physiological traits, or we can do pathology, look for any signs of disease or parasitism in the fish. So you can subsample a very small number at random to do those more laboratory welfare indicators. So there certainly is like a wealth of information out there that needs to really be brought together to ensure that we're meeting the needs of farmed salmon, that they are living a good life, and that their health is being maintained during that process, but also that there's going to be action taken if say, for example, 10% of the fish start exhibiting signs of aggression. What are the industry then going to do about it?
Thank you. Just one final very small question then. Do we have a good overview at the moment of fish welfare within salmon farming?
I think there are numerous studies that have investigated various aspects of salmon behaviour, salmon feeding rates, salmon growth, reproduction, that we can come up with indicators of good health and welfare. So I would say yes, it's just putting that information together and getting agreement and buy-in from the industry.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
I'm okay, thanks, Convener. I think my questions have been covered.
No, not yet. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to come in on the back of Emma Ruddock's questions there, and I'll address this to Professor Lynn Snedden. And it's you mentioned earlier the RAS and the lumpfish, so what we call collectively the cleaner fish. And we've been focusing just now on the welfare of the salmon, but I'd be interested to hear from you if you could describe the welfare of the lumpfish and the RAS when they're in the salmon cages and any concerns that you have for them.
Yeah, sure. So these animals are either taken from the wild situation, so they're caught in fisheries, then they're transported to these salmon cages, which is a very artificial environment. Or there is moves now, and I know there's many facilities in the UK now actually farming lumpfish for this very purpose. And so in terms of taking an animal from the wild, it would be ethically perhaps more acceptable to farm the animals rather than going out and catching them and disturbing wild populations. And there's been quite a big public outcry about that here in Sweden over the last week, that Swedish lumpfish are being caught to be taken to Norway to sit in salmon cages to eat salmon lice. So these animals are put in usually a certain size, and then they're effectively left to fend for themselves. They have to learn to actually feed off the salmon. As I said before, about a third of them perish within the first few weeks. They just don't acclimate or adapt to that new environment. Perhaps that's because of the stress of being taken from the wild. Perhaps that's because they just don't feed on any of the salmon lice, so they starve to death. There is supplementary feeding in some farms, so they'll actually add food for the lumpfish. And then typically they're left there to the end of the production cycle, and then they just effectively perish because they're not used then for any other purpose. There has been some improvement in their welfare. Some farms are putting in environmental enrichment, so they have like ropes or fake kind of seaweed fronds, because these the lumpfish in particular have a sucker on the bottom of the body, and they like to suck onto stones or onto other substrates to rest. And so by providing this kind of enrichment, that has actually improved or reduced the mortality rate of the lumpfish, that they have been giving some space to actually suck onto, because that's kind of a behavioural need for them. But overall, I think there are very few studies looking at what happens to individual lumpfish when they go into these sea cages or the RAS, and there does seem to be quite high mortality. And once they reach a certain size, they stop feeding on the sea lice. And so really they're sort of sitting there in the cage, and it's likely that they will be exposed to any of the treatments, whether that be chemical treatment or physical treatments for salmon lice. And of course, the same experience, they will be affected in the same way as the salmon are by these treatments.
But sorry, I'm going to interrupt you. Your points to me are really valid, but we need to not get into too much detail. It's make sure we're concentrating on the recommendations and whatever. So I'm going to move on to a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Vina, SEPA figures indicate that in Scotland, 17 million farm salmon died last year, and so therefore, this is indicating that mortality rates remain high on fish farms. Is there scientific consensus on the key causes of why this is happening? And if so, how are those? How is that data recorded, and is it published and aggregated? Can I start off with Sam Martin?
Okay, yeah, so the industry has made big efforts through Scottish Salmon to publish all the mortality data on a monthly basis of over every single site in Scotland, and it always makes, I look at that very, very regularly, just for interest to see what the reporting mortalities have been caused by. If you go through that, nearly all the major fish mortality rates are recorded as gill health or varus, or a combination of gill health and varus. As I said, it's very, very rarely sea lice. So one of the issues is that there are a number of viruses that affect fish, and the terminal tissue that the virus goes to is the heart. If you have a virus in the heart which is causing some kind of pathology in the heart, where your heart muscle maybe gets some kind of histopathology in it, that weakens the capacity of the fish to pump the blood around the body. And also, if you have compromised gills, which might be coming from micro jellyfish or parasites, microscopic parasites that attach onto the gills, then you have a double issue. You have a poor heart and you've got poor gills. Then if you try and do some kind of treatment, potentially for lice or just whatever kind of, you know, treatment you're trying to do with fish or moving a fish about, they can succumb to these, you know, just the physiological stress. So most of the time that is actually what the mortality is. It's sort of a combination of multiple factors coming together. Another area of mortality is whenever the salmon life cycle is very complex. They spend the first year in fresh water, and mostly in these what we call recirculation hatcheries now, where the water is reused. Very, very pristine, clean environments. And then they get transferred into the marine cages under a stage called smoltification, going from freshwater to saltwater. That's a very vulnerable stage for the fish because they're having to change all their osmoregulatory ability. And we know that that is a stage where we call them post-smolts, and their immune system, we know, is decreased and they can become very susceptible to new pathogens. So we're vaccinated in fresh water, they get transferred to salt water where they are exposed to multiple agents which can be, you know, not good for the fish. And especially at the moment, you know, the last couple of years where we haven't had cold winters, a lot of the parasites have not been cleared out because of cold water temperatures. So normally you'd see mortality cyclical, where in the end of the summer, autumn going into winter is where you'd have your highest mortalities. Those would drop off dramatically at the end of winter into the spring where you've had a cold winter. The water pretty well cleans itself out and then it would happen again. Over the last couple of years, because we've had much, much warmer winters, the water hasn't really had a chance to temperature to go down. And there's been an ongoing gill health issue with other compromising factors which are resulting in these high mortalities. Mortalities are far too high. No farmer or researcher wants to see high mortalities. I mean, it's just not where you want to go. But that's really where most of the mortalities are, if you look at the public data from Scottish salmon.
OK, thank you. Professor McKenzie.
I think we should start by saying that, yes, 17 million fish in Scotland and 65 million fish in Norway, and an annual mortality is not a sustainable practice in that sense. And the targets that need to be set, or let's say even just the aspirations of what is acceptable mortality within that food production system, has to be debated. And I think, as Lynn was suggesting previously, it also has to have some bite behind it, because otherwise change does not happen in that sense. Okay, so I think that's okay, and I agree that all stakeholders in the system do not want to see this type of mortality. I think if you look at the trajectory over the last 10 to 15 years, it's a complex scenario, and everybody's always going to say it's quite complex. But the mortality is, I think there's becoming a consensus as to do with the husbandry operation, and what you're doing to them and where you're doing it to, and the site, which is about where's your consenting, where you're putting your sites, are they good sites, are they bad sites. There's a sort of integration happening, which is also what Annette was talking about in terms of the data and how we're doing that. Gains have to be made. And the only way the gains can be made is by integrating the research, knowledge and culture into the industry and making that happen. And that has several drivers, yeah? That has policy, it has regulation, it has multiple things, but it has to be based upon the science that is being evidenced as we go forward now. And if you look at the amount of data that we get now compared to what we had 10 years ago, it's absolutely massive. It's orders of magnitude higher. And I think a lot of the time this is about decision-making processes and how do we make that work. I think a lot of data is there. Setting up the structures to act upon them, I think, is the key.
Does the farm salmon industry work with the universities and actually pay them to do this type of work? Because what kind of producer would want to have welfare issues? What kind of producer would want to have such, you know, mortality rates? Yes. This is affecting profits. It's also affecting, I presume, worker welfare, because why, and also coastal communities, because why would anyone want to see discarded fish or lorries leaving fish farms with dead fish? I mean, do they actually work with universities to try to establish...
Absolutely. Right. No, absolutely. I'm not going to jump in, but absolutely. So, I mean, I think everybody, all the scientists you've got here, you don't do aquaculture science unless you're working in that space. Now, that might be production companies, it might be pharmaceutical, it might be environment. We work across a huge range of diversity in that space. There's no doubt about that. I think sometimes for our nation, if we look at what we're doing compared to other competing nations we might want to say in the salmon world, we are under-investing hugely in our space, and we're relying a lot on what's happening in other countries to bring that information together, and that's not a positive state of affairs for Scotland in the great scheme of things, because it's very different, Scotland, to the other competitor nations if we look at it like that.
But if I develop this, you know, I asked about, is there scientific consensus around why the mortality rates are increasing, and Professor Martin said, you know, that there's the situation with the microfish jelly, there's obviously warming waters, but nobody's mentioned the increase in the number of salmon being produced and whether that's having an impact, or perhaps the use of technology, and the risk is greater using the technology, even though some people have said that it is actually helping. So where is the scientific, you know, you are the scientists, where is the scientific consensus about tackling mortality rates?
I'll just say something.
I would like to bring in Annette. Annette indicated she'd like to come in some time ago.
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to point out that actually we're in a really fortunate position that all the data is public. Because I'm an epidemiologist, my colleagues work a lot in other sectors as well, and that is not always the case. So actually it is relatively easy to see where the problems are at the moment. As a scientist, you always want to find out what the problems are going to be in 5 years, because you want your research to be a little bit advanced when the problems get bigger, because they need solving then at that moment, and that's a very challenging thing to do. But we're trying all the time. But yeah, I just wanted to point out that data is there, and that we are having access to it, so we can actually know that we need to focus on gill health right now, because that's one of and the viruses, as Sam alluded to, that those are the major problems right now. And yeah, I totally agree. The industry, no one wants to see these high numbers. And as Scotland, we're a bit smaller, so we rely quite a bit on what happens in Norway. They have exactly the same problems with mortality that ideally needs to come down. Similar challenges. So we're trying to work together to find out how we can solve the problems that are today, reduce that mortality, but also try to anticipate what's coming, I would say. And having access to some open data is very important, makes that actually, yeah, better possible than if that weren't the case and you actually had to pull all those resources together to start with. Thank you.
I'm going to make Sam and then Simon.
Yeah, in the previous reports which were generated, there was discussion about moving sites to areas which maybe would card it as more higher energy sites, but we all know that we work with the industry, and the industry knows there's particular some locations which are generally the fish don't perform as well as other sites. And as I understand, there was a wish to move sites to areas which maybe would be predicted as being better for fish health, and of course that health is welfare. But this is outside my research area, but I do understand that it's very difficult to get permission and licences to go to areas which I think would be the more healthy areas, or even expand at those areas and then move their fish away. But if they have their licence, and these might have been going back to the 1990s when it was just starting, and they're still farming there because they can't put them anywhere else, I think, you know, looking forward in the next few years, if that was possible to do, then you could mitigate some of these issues.
Simon?
Thank you. I'd just like to highlight there's one really, really important thing that sits in here is behind, in order to evaluate technologies, you need to have the research infrastructures to be able to do that. All right? So if we look at the UK and we look at the research infrastructures, we have to work within that size and scale of space So recently, obviously, in Stirling, we have the National Aquaculture Technology Innovation Hub. But there remains one huge gap, and it's very relevant to what everybody's talking around the table. We do not have any sea cage facilities in Scotland which can be run for research, and that they have to be production sites. So we're generally chasing our tails always when we're talking about different types of tech. And you're going to different sites which have different environmental conditions, and these variables make it very difficult to you to come to a scientific consensus. So if you don't have that integrated infrastructure in that space where you can measure that using scientists to make that work, okay, it makes it very difficult to get to conclusions, because you know, site A versus site B versus site C have got different characteristics, and it makes it very difficult for us to pinpoint and say, okay, so let's say the use of that mechanical technology, okay, we can measure it again and again and again, and then we can make it really clear and make a call to that. We don't have that capability in the UK. So that gap right there when we're talking about going to sea cage, it's not there. So you don't have, and this takes me kind of to the, actually almost to the point of view of, in terms of planning and how do you get research license sites and that sort of thing. So in Norway, that capability is there and they do that. In Scotland, we don't have that capability, which actually holds us back a lot, because our conditions environmentally are very different to the other countries as well. So it's quite difficult for us to generate a global view or a consensual view for Scotland, rather than being reliant upon other data from other places.
Why can't we get these research licence sites?
That is not within my gift, I'm afraid.
But I suppose the question is that research capability available in other parts of the world? Is
yes.
it just it's just
yes.
Scotland that's the issue?
Yes.
Okay, that's really helpful. So one of the recommendations was coordination with data and comprehensive overview of all fish health, welfare and treatment issues across the sector. Have we made improvements over the last 5 years to ensure there's coordination? Is it better than it was 5 years ago, the coordination of the fish health data?
It's better than it was 5 years ago, but we're not at a...
Still not there.
We're still not there yet. There has been some efforts to create a website, Aquaculture Scotland, where these data can be compiled and presented in one public place. But I think we're getting there. There are some efforts to try and bring it together and improve the reporting. There is a huge amount of data out there, and the producers themselves are investing huge amounts in measuring things and monitoring things, and a lot of that is kept in commercial confidence, and accessing that data is a huge challenge. And I think we have made improvements, but I don't think we're at a place yet where we can easily access it.
Okay.
We're not there yet, no.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
I think you answered my question. It was about sea cage research sites elsewhere on the globe. And I suppose what's the barrier to Scotland having it? Is it just cost?
Yeah, I think cost is a significant factor here. I think actually you probably have stakeholders who are open to doing that, as in industry partners who are willing to do that sort of thing. So it's just it's cost and making it happen. And it has to be a national resource, because these things lose money. Research infrastructures lose money, there's no doubt about that. That's not making you a profit. But it's a fundamental piece of our story, our puzzle, and how we want to work in that space. So, yeah, that's having the right stakeholders and the will to make it happen.
Okay, thanks. Emma Roddick.
Thank you. I just want to ask a bit about fish escapes. So earlier on, we heard some uncertainty around what can be done to prevent escapes. So I'm wondering how the recommendation to take a precautionary approach can be met by farms if it's unclear what can be done to actually prevent that from occurring in the first place.
I'll kick off, I suppose. The worry about salmon escaping is, in case they breed with wild population of salmon, clearly, you know, that's what it is. And 20 years ago, there was probably many, many more fish escaping for the number of fish which were being farmed than there are now. Escapes happen due to storm damage, due to seal damage of cages. That's really the two ways that fish will escape. The fish which are farmed now are very different to what the wild salmon is. It's been under probably 8 generations of very heavy selection towards growing fast and having massively reduced stress response, I suppose. If you keep wild salmon in a tank and you keep farm salmon in another tank beside, like, they're completely different behaviour. So the farm salmon, if they escape now, will not do very well. They'll be selected against very, very strongly compared to fish with wild genes. But, of course, if they get saturated, if there's many, many of them, then that will cause a long-term impact. Trying to prevent escape, of course, I mean, if a fish farmer loses fish, they don't want to. That's where losing money. And it used to be a big, big concern in the west of Scotland. You know, that there were a lot of escaped fish in the west of Ireland as well. There would be escaped fish. But what can they do to reduce it? I suppose, I mean, they're continually trying to improve it, the quality of the nets and just trying to prevent, you know, escapes. I mean, that's not my expertise. You know, maybe Simon might know a bit more about escapes than me.
I'm afraid not. I do know about some nice technologies, though. So there's some nice technologies out there which now tell you in real time when there's a breach made in the net, so the operators can go straight there. So it's linked into your internet, so you can actually map across all your cages and see when that open, there's a space, and get in there faster as a mitigation context for escape, yeah?
Yeah. I suppose the great variation between years of numbers of escapes in Scotland kind of suggests to me that there's not a clear way of preventing entirely salmon from escaping. So I'd like to be a bit more clear on how people can meet that ask of taking a precautionary approach to escapes.
Helena?
No.
You'd have to have a land-based system to make that happen. Right. Or some of the new technologies which are being used in Norwegian water, for example, there's different containment, closed containment systems or whatever.
That recommendation can't have been
escapes,
met.
I think opens a door to different discussions about genetic integration and impact upon wild populations, which has to be taken into context and really, and how much of that is actually happening. What does it really look like? I think sometimes the science, and you know more about this one than me, that science is, let's say, there's some debate in that area.
So since 2018, that recommendation hasn't been met, largely because it couldn't be met?
I can't answer that question. I don't know the answer to that.
Okay.
Yeah, Dad, I think the way the industry are tackling escapees is mainly from an improved technology perspective and the construction of the cages. And double netting, I was hearing about that recently, seems to be a really effective method. And I think, it's in their interest not to have escapees. That's money out the net then. So they have been really investing in the technology. And the technology around the nets is really quite incredible. The monitoring of the nets and the construction of the pens has undergone huge development and huge investment, and we don't have the same farms that we had 20 years ago. So I can't speak on the data of the escapees. That's really not my area. But
and Annette.
Okay, thanks. It's also not my area of expertise, but you're right. The fact that the data is so variable shows that it's not a constant amount, because then you could do something against it. It's really incidents where it currently is, and all you can do is, I suppose, trying to understand what happens and do that better. And I think it's quite a good thing that SKPs always have to be registered. So that is really an incentive, because people can see where the escapes are. So it's an incentive for farms to make sure that doesn't happen to your farm. I think that's a really good thing.
Thank you. The REC committee once again reported that they identified a lack of scientific data into the interactions between farmed and wild salmon. Can you tell us whether the research for that has developed over the last 6 years since the committee recommendations? And is there still knowledge gaps? Simon?
Is that to me? Oh, sorry?
Yes, whoever feels most qualified to answer. Are we, Sam?
Yeah, I don't do this work myself, but certainly Marine Science Scotland or Marine Directorate probably would be the lead researchers in that. They are working probably most on that in their labs at Pitlochry to look at the farmed-wild interactions. So it's probably beyond the work that we do.
Absolutely. Our focus with the wild fish is more sitting in conservation aquaculture, which is a different story. Yeah, okay. It's a different rather than interaction. It's how do you support those populations?
Okay, that's fine. Thanks, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. It's been touched on already, but you know, we've mentioned the interaction between farmed salmon and wild salmon. So I just wondered if you could say a little about the data on that, but more specifically, whether the, in your view, whether the regulations are keeping up with any issues around that.
That may be a very similar response to the question, yeah. I had, unfortunately. If nobody feels they've got a view on the interaction between wild and farmed, we'll leave that there.
Okay. So the new sea lice risk assessment framework is really seeking to protect the wild salmon. So that is a regulatory framework that really links both the sources of, or the presumed sources of lice from aquaculture to impacts on wild salmon. And I guess, in my own opinion, it's actually perhaps a bit of a disconnect as well. We have different communities of researchers, different interest groups that either work on one side or the other. So to get the two sides to work together is really challenging, and the new framework is trying to do that. But to really monitor how one industry is affecting a very complex species that has very complicated routes of migration and behaviour in the water is not an easy thing. And from my expertise, I don't think we're addressing it as directly as we could do, because we're in different communities, really.
Okay, thanks, Simon.
I don't want to talk specifically there, but something quite related to that. If you look at the traffic light system in Norway, which is the red, amber, green, and how do they do it? Because that's based on sea lice numbers and wild smolts. Yeah? So the 10%, 10%, 30% story. There's quite strong evidence now showing that in order to keep to those levels, there are increases in the level of non-medicinal treatment on farms, which is then impacting and driving mortality on the other side. So it's a critical issue, but all stakeholders need to be brought to the table to talk to that. Okay. You're artificially driving mortality in the aquaculture thing at the same time. So it's a very sensitive issue, critical issue.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. The Scottish Animal Welfare Commission considers this a need for further research on cetaceans, on alternatives to acoustic deterrent devices to reduce risks to cetaceans. So I just wondered if you can say anything about the research in this area, and are there any research gaps in that area, and looking at the stress on salmon of seals floating around outside the cage, and if you could say anything about that.
I could comment, this is not my area of expertise, but I work quite closely with colleagues that work on the sea mammal side, and as far as I'm aware, the acoustic deterrent devices have now been banned. So from the aquaculture side, it is a bit of a loss of a tool that was useful in deterring seals and reducing escapees and reducing damage and mortality from them. I think there are some very interesting developments in also considering acoustics, but seeing whether really targeted acoustics could be developed that are much more specific to the problem seals and are not so generalised impacts like the previous round of devices. So I think that's an area of active research. But as far as I'm aware at the moment, we don't have any tools. It's just research on it, or on finding replacements or solutions to deter the problematic seals.
Okay. Any other comments? No? Emma?
Of the risk to cetaceans, are there alternatives to the ADDs that are posing threats to cetaceans as well?
That I'm familiar with.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Edward Mington.
Thank you very much, Convener. Sam, I want to drill down into something you said. You said that sea lice don't kill fish, but then 15 minutes later, you said that if they're not treated, they will allow in other diseases which could kill those fish. So it's a bit like saying stage one cancer doesn't kill you, but the follow-on cancers will kill you. Is that not right? So sea lice do kill fish?
I don't. In the farm situation, sea lice are left to proliferate beyond where they should be allowed to. The fish will succumb to secondary infections and things, and then they would get killed, they would die. But on a wider scale, in the farm situation, we don't see fish being killed at high levels by sea lice. The treatments to keep the lice numbers down at very, very low levels, that can cause mortality because of these other secondary problems which we've mentioned already.
Okay, so Salmon Scotland on their website say they have to control sea lice for the simple reason that if they don't, other infections will come in, which, because the sea lice have disturbed the balance of the salmon skin, it will kill them. But another infection, that is.
The reason they keep the lice numbers down, it's a sort of code of practice that they don't want to have X number of gravid females on the fish, which is probably less than what wild salmon would have. So wild salmon all have sea lice on them?
I'll come to wild salmon. I'm trying to identify if sea lice get on a fish in sufficient numbers, they will compromise that fish, allowing other diseases in, which could then kill them.
Yes.
So sea lice do kill fish. So on that basis, that would be right. One of the things that when salmon farmers put out juvenile fish is they treat them before they go out because they're particularly susceptible to disease when they move out, including sea lice, because their skin are particularly thin and liable to be affected by sea lice. Is that not right?
They normally give us, quite often they'll give a slice treatment, this drug post-transfer. When they go out, they
Because they're particularly vulnerable when they're juveniles.
And the numbers will get up to when they have to treat them. So if the lice numbers get up to a certain level, they will then also be allowed to go to the veterinary vets and say, we need to give them an additional treatment. So, and within that site, they're only allowed to give that amount of treatment per tonnes. I mean, I'm not sure what the numbers are. But
so if we're going to deal with the issue that wild fish interests believe that sea lice affect their, you know, the juveniles going out to sea, the only way we're going to be able to prove whether it kills them is to trap them after they've gone through a heavily sea lice infected area and see whether they die. Because to say that there is no evidence that they don't die is based on no research at all.
So I wasn't talking about wild fish. I was talking about...
I'm looking for you to agree or disagree.
Yeah. So there have been... In Ireland, there was quite a lot of experiments went on a while ago where they had hatcheries for wild fish and they treated them before they went to sea and then monitored the treated and the non-treated ones coming back. They didn't really get any very, very strong conclusions from that because of the heterogeneity within their experiments. And of course, they were also hatchery fish. They weren't wild fish. Hatchery fish released in the wild do very, very badly compared to wild, natural-produced smolts. The Marine Scotland... now Marine Director, whatever they call themselves now, we're doing a lot of experiments trying to understand survival of smolts in the west of Scotland going out. And as I understand, the numbers of fish were able to get in their traps were never high enough to be able to make any proper statistical inference from that. So, yes, there is a big... The wild fish... I know quite a lot about wild fish. I'm an angler myself. The fact that there's a concern about fish swimming past the cages, picking up lice... what happens to them.
Okay.
Now, we don't know because it's a very difficult area to do research on. As you say, you'd have to then be catching a wild fish after they go past the cages, but it's very difficult to know where they go, and there's not so many wild salmon anymore as there was 30 or 40 years ago.
So, anecdotally, one of the reasons why the fish farm at Loch Hugh was moved is because some of the sea trout that were turning in were actually smolt sea trout going out to sea and were coming back before they did spend any time at sea because they had absolutely no fins left on them at all. They were destroyed. They were effectively dying in the river, but trying to get back into fresh water because for some reason they knew that fresh water would get rid of the lice. So you accept there could be a serious problem with this?
If you get very high levels of lice on animals, yes.
Thank you. Convener, I'd like to just go to Annette.
Just as long as we stick to what the inquiry is about, and that's looking at the REC recommendations that you're very familiar with, and not deep diving into too many specifics. That would be helpful.
I'm absolutely not deep diving, Convener, and I will stick to the points. But if evidence is given to this committee that I think is fundamentally flawed, I must challenge it. Otherwise, it won't be on the official record. Annette, I hope you're in Inverness in that wonderful centre that I visited the other day. I just wanted to probe on antibiotic resistance and chemical resistance. Antibiotic use leads to antibiotic resistance. Are we seeing that in salmon farming? And is that a factor of the increased use of chemicals, or is that not something that we should worry about?
I think antibiotic resistance is always something we should worry about. I have not worked with any data on that for fish, so I can't really be any more specific than that, if we should worry about that in this specific case. But it is just very important, especially for human population going forward, but also animal populations, because we want to be able to treat them in the future as well, that we keep a very close eye on it. But beyond this this general understanding, I haven't been looking at any of that data.
I think I share your concern if it's oxytetracycline that's being used as an antibiotic, which is used in humans, and there's resistance being built up in that. That would cause me some concern.
Simon.
Just a quick comment about AMR in aquaculture systems. So right now we're working in a very large-scale European project, which is called CIRCLES. We've been working on that for the last 7 years, and that because all salmon farming across Europe and all the farming systems, terrestrial plus aquatic, and we're at the point, I would say, in 6 months' time that we'll be able to give that data, map that AMR data right across the system. So we're not too far away from that at this moment in time.
Okay. Sorry, Convener, can I follow up on that particular one? If you're going to give us data in 6 months' time, you might have some thoughts on how things are progressing at the moment.
Yeah, I can do.
Is AMR some concern?
There's AMR presence, so there is presence, but there doesn't seem to be... I need to contextualise this, OK? if you look at it in Northern European AMR context versus, let's call it, a Thailand or a Vietnam context, when Pangasius aquaculture, for example, where there's a huge use of antibiotic, it's very easy to pick up AMR and the proliferation and movement of AMR across different bacterial communities, because that's what you're looking at, really. You're looking at the transfer of that capability. Mm-hmm. We're not finding that hugely in neither Norway nor Scotland nor Ireland.
So, but fish can build up AMR?
No, it's not fish that build up, it's bacteria that generate.
Yeah,
it's not
but
fish.
I mean, the diseases that affect fish can pick up AMR.
No.
Or are you not saying?
No.
Are you saying they can't?
So you're referring to sort of tetracycline resistance, that's what you're saying before. Under the right conditions, that is possible, but whether those conditions exist is still a moot point.
Okay, well, I'll have to wait to read your report.
It's a really nice piece of work because there's a lot of teams in there, so it's
I'd
very
love
solid.
To see it if you send
it's very
it
solid. Solid.
Thank you very much, Camilla.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. My colleague Edward Mountain has now got my cogs working on this gill health and sea lice interaction. And obviously, the government have brought in this new regulatory obligation for fish farms to meet in terms of the threshold of sea lice. And then the ways that we're controlling the sea lice are clearly having an impact on fish health and specifically on the gill health. So basically, we have brought in something and then created a new problem. So do we need, as a committee, to be making sure that we're looking at whether sea lice control is being done in the correct way? Because this could be, as Professor Martin said, the reason why mortality levels have increased so dramatically.
Yeah, so just to maybe reword a bit of what you said there, you said that the lice treatments are causing the gill health issues. The fish are having gill health issues. first, and then if they're bad, they go into a sea lice treatment, and then that can compromise the fish. So the lice treatments as such are not causing the gill health issues. The gill health issues are environmental challenges on the fish by pathogens and by microjellyfish, storm damage, natural occurring plankton. If the gills are damaged, then the fish are less able to withstand these procedures which are used to remove the lice. Mm. It's not the other way around. So the gill health has to be good, and that's one of the big areas of our research team, is trying to understand the mechanisms, causes of gill health, getting early warning indicators for the farms that we'll be able to say, based on X, Y, or Z, your gills look like they're becoming compromised. Therefore, we'll advise you maybe to do procedure X, Y, or Z for looking after the lice. So if the gills were of a particular level of damage, and they're doing this themselves all the time now, but we're trying to speed this up, they would make a decision, an informed decision, based on their health managers, what treatment they might do. But of course, we want to bring that forward and give them better warnings. So Stirling, UHI, Aberdeen, we're all working on joint and separate projects, all trying to understand the causes of gill health, which then gives the fish farmers that knowledge to then how might they deal with other things.
Mm. Okay,
so
thanks.
That's the way round it is. Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Okay, we have no further questions, so can I thank you all for your attendance this morning. Once again, that evidence has been hugely helpful and help us in our inquiry. That concludes our business in public today, and we now move into private session.